You could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here with me. Me.
You are now tuned into the Boxing Voice Radio. Join us every Thursday and Sunday, live at 7 p.m. Eastern Time.
TheBoxingVoice.com.
Remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
Subscribe to youtube.com/TheBoxingVoice for the latest and greatest interviews with your favorite fighters.
All right, fight fans. We are live. I'm waiting for my co-host to get with me. See if they can join me here on today's show. Vic is having some difficulties with internet. Mario is running a little bit behind schedule, but I'm pretty sure they will be here. I mean, who wants to miss the Mayweather versus Guerrero post-fight show? I mean, let's be honest. It was the biggest night of boxing was last night, and Mayweather lived up to the part. He definitely did, man. I mean, he put on a boxing clinic, and I've been watching Twitter very closely, and I know there's some mixed signals. A lot of people feel like this fight was never, I don't know, anything close, or they never figured it would be close. They figured Mayweather would be too much for Guerrero, and it kind of proved to be that in the fight. And that's understandable, but at the end of the day, the man put on a boxing clinic. I don't feel that there's anyone in the welterweight division that would have handed Robert Guerrero a loss that way. I mean, he basically pitched the shutout. But look, I mean, no sense in hearing me. I want to hear from you guys here. What's your thoughts? How do you see the fight going? Let's talk the undercards. I don't know. I know I'm a Rosado fan. You guys know that I picked Jay Leon Love, so I batted 4-for-4. Unfortunately, my co-hosts aren't here so that I can gloat, but we all know I batted 4-for-4. I got 4 out of 4 right. I picked Love, but like I said on the show, I knew that Rosado wouldn't get the nod, but I felt Rosado beat Love. So I want to hear what you guys got to say. See how you've seen these fights going. You know, the big news, I guess, is that the Mayweather. Oh, we got our first guest. Bao Kang, what's up, brother?
Hey, Ness. How you doing?
I'm good, brother.
Yeah, man. Did you get my message?
I am reading it now, but go ahead and let the world know what it was, unless that was only for my eyes.
No, what I'm saying is that, man, it was a good boxing, talking about the undercard there. I like Leo Santa Cruz, you know. I had Rosado winning as well. I didn't make a prediction on him because I knew he was going to get robbed. So, but I thought with the experience that he'd been in with Golovkin, I felt that Rosado would be too much for Jay Leon Love. And he put him down in the eighth round, I think it was, wasn't it?
Yeah, I believe it was eighth.
Yeah, so I he got robbed on that, but it was interesting after the post fight where they were quite humble, weren't they, towards each other?
Well, I don't know if they were necessarily humble. I mean,
well, Rosado wasn't. He kind of said, "I won the fight."
Yeah, he said he won the fight. He said that he felt the fans knew that he won the fight. He said he felt that he deserved a title shot. And it's looking like the winner was supposed to get a title shot with Peter Quillen. I don't think that Jay Leon Love, whether he got the win or not, I doubt that Mayweather Promotions is going to put him in there with Peter Quillen. He's nowhere near ready.
No chance. No way. He's nowhere near ready, man. He's too raw. There's so much flaws in his defense, man.
Yeah.
But I like Leo Santa Cruz. He reminded me of like a mini Margarito.
Was that your first time seeing him?
Nah. I've seen him before, but I thought in that fight, I mean, I predicted he'd be he might be the first one to stop Munoz, because he'd been out for so long, because he ain't been stopped before.
Yeah, well, I expected that. We all picked Santa Cruz to do what he did.
Yeah.
It was basically inevitable. I mean,
what do you think of Mayweather's performance then?
Flawless.
Yeah.
Magnificent. For everyone that thought that he lost a step, boy, was I wrong. I mean, I picked Mayweather to win, but I thought that Guerrero would give him some trouble, and wow. He just looked amazing.
I think, for the first six rounds, he looked really well. But he got flat-footed after after that. And Guerrero, I think, was an ideal opponent for him. But yes, the straight right hand looked fantastic. But I think, again, an ideal opponent. But there's so much more, you know, surrounding the bigger picture here with this Showtime deal. And how did you feel that how he looked with... I mean, I don't think Mayweather looks himself, you know, with this Showtime deal now. He just doesn't seem himself.
He looked better than in the past, I'll tell you that. I mean, I know people are a bit upset. Hey, Bal, I'm going to let you go. I got another call, all right?
Okay, cool.
What up? It's a maniac,
maniac. it wouldn't be right.
What's good, baby?
Hello. For all those that don't know,
this is Boogie Down Sean, the Maniac.
Yeah, man, you already know who it is, man. This is the freaking Maniac, man. And, you know, I'm going to just come out and just be straightforward, man. Look, I give Floyd much credit for his victory yesterday. Yes, he put on the clinic against Guerrero. You know, give him that. It's no hating, because people always get me confused as a Floyd hater opposed to being a Floyd realist. You know what I'm saying? If I was a hater, I'd call him a bum. If I was a Floyd hater, I'd say he ain't shit. That's not the case, man. It's obviously the guy is very, very talented. But now, people jumping on the TLs, man, like, he just beat Roberto Duran, man. This is Rob Guerrero. Nah, he's a solid fighter. That's what Guerrero is, a solid. Oh, but he beat Berto and Aideen. Let's be real, man. Aideen, he just got outboxed by a brawler in his last fight. Listen clearly, outboxed by a brawler in Soto Caraz. And Berto, we know Berto is just overhyped, you know, another Mir Khan. Supposed to be these big superstars, but then get beat up when it's time, when they get that big fight. Now, I'm going to say this too. Floyd fans are the most hypocrite fans on this earth. It's okay for Floyd to go up to 154 to fight Oscar De La Hoya for a big payday. It's okay for him to go fight Cora at 54 for a big payday. Or all of a sudden, nobody wants him to fight Canelo. No, why should he fight Canelo? He's the cash cow. Well, last time I checked, Floyd fights for money, right? This is called prize fighting. There's no bigger payday out there than Canelo. And your last fight was at 154. So it's not like, oh, he hasn't fought at that weight in 8-9 years. That was a long. No, he fought last May. He fought at 154. And De La Hoya and Cotto was at least 15 pounds heavier than him, you know, when he fought him. So what's the problem with Canelo now? I'm not saying Canelo beats Floyd. I'm just saying you're the so-called best fighter in this era, and you're so good. Say, you know what? That's who y'all want me to fight? I fought there before. Let me go up there and fight. People crying, oh, why Canelo don't go up to 160? Last time I checked, Canelo never had a fight at 160. Last time I checked, Floyd had two fights at 154, only for paydays. Canelo right now would sell out in 2 days if there was the fight. So I do not understand that, man. Just fight fighters that people, what are you going to fight? Alexander Amir Khan? Alexander who quit against Bradley? Alexander who got a give decision against Matisse? Amir Khan, very another talented, but stays getting beat up. Come on, man. I'm tired of it, man. Or you a Floyd hater. Why am I a hater? That's being a realist, man. He's always fighting flat-footed, easy-to-hit fighters, man. If nobody can't see that, I don't know what to say,
something.
Man. That's not hating. That's, you know, that's just real. If anything there's hate, go ahead. I'm sorry, Nuts.
Nah, I just want to ask you, wasn't Guerrero the most credible opponent that he could have fought? If he would have fought Devin Alexander, wouldn't you be saying he should have fought Guerrero?
The thing is that Guerrero, the reason why he fought Guerrero, one, he was a Mexican fighter. To me personally, he should have fought Trout right after he beat Cotto. People's going to say, come on, Dawes, you don't even make sense. Oh, I don't make sense. Why not? He just beat the fighter you beat. You understand? Why not fight a young lion? Bernard Hopkins is still doing it. Oh, but who knows Trout? Well, when Cotto fought Trout, who the fuck was Trout? But Cotto still fought him. You understand? This is the thing with Floyd. Floyd fans are hypocrites. It's like, oh, who's he? Who's he? It doesn't fucking matter who Floyd fights, man. It's going to sell, man. People don't understand that. He could fight me next. He could fight your mailman. He could fight your plumber. He could fight the guy that make your sandwiches in the store. It's going to sell. Stop with this bullshit. Who's that? Who's that? It doesn't matter. Oh, he's a welterweight. No, let him fight welterweights. Okay, no problem. Let him fight welterweights. But why he's going to stay up there at 140, stay there at 147 when there's a huge payday at 54 at a weight he's fought at before? Let's get this clear. I'm not asking him to go to 160 because that's ridiculous. 154, the fight a huge, I mean a massive payday. Massive payday. You understand?
Sean,
you
mean,
understand?
So I
don't understand that, man. What?
You called it numerous times, and you had your own show. I never heard you saying that Guerrero was a bad opponent.
I said it was a mismatch. I put it on Twitter plenty of times, and you know, I follow along with other Floyd fans follow me. And they all rip it. Oh, you see, you never gave him credit. Guerrero's tough. Last time I checked, Donaire was on number 3 pound for pound list. And Ricky made him look like a bum. And yeah, he got props. It was like, okay, Floyd did what he did yesterday. And it's like he beat Sugar Ray Leonard. It's like, yo, come on, man. That's Guerrero. He's just a tough fighter. That's all he is. A tough fighter. He's solid. You understand? He beat Berto. It was a tough fight. He didn't run through Berto. It was a tough fight. Yes, he won it clearly, but he won. Then the 18 fight, man, it was a close fight. That was a close fight. He won it, but it was close. Now he was dominating fighters, and it's like, yo, yeah. Floyd even said it, man. He chose this fight for a reason, man. He said he was not as tough as Cotto. He knows that. There's a reason, and people get mad. Yo, fight at 150. Oh, but he's too big for him. So what it is then? So why Floyd could fight Cotto at 54, but he can't fight nobody else at 54? You understand this? It's like, I got beef for you and your man, but your man is 5 foot. So I want to fight him, but I don't want to fight you because you're too tall for me. You understand? Like, I don't make no sense, dog. It is what it is, right? It's prize fighting. Canelo gives Mayweather the biggest payday out there. Once again, I'm not saying Canelo beats Floyd. I'm not saying, oh, it's not that, oh, you want to see him lose. No, I just want to see Floyd fight the toughest fighter out there. That's all it is. Guerrero, yo, listen, Pacquiao would have stopped Guerrero yesterday. If not stopped him, he would abuse that boy. I think Bradley fights the way he fights. He beats Guerrero. I even think Marquez beats Guerrero. Tougher fights, I don't think they'll dominate Guerrero like Mayweather did, but I think they all beat him. And I think Pacquiao does something similar. The only difference is I think Pacquiao will get hit a little bit more. But I think he dominates Guerrero. So for those that say, oh, but who else is a mismatch for Guerrero, for Guerrero at 147? I just named them Pacquiao. And I think Bradley and Marquez, I'll choose both of them to beat Guerrero at 147. So for those that are trying to say, oh, but, you know, how are you trying to discredit Floyd? He's not discrediting him. I'm giving him credit for beating Guerrero. But how many people really, you know what, Ness? Ask people four fighters Guerrero beat. I bet you none of them, they can't name four fighters. You understand? That's what I'm saying. So how these people talking about, oh, he's tough. He's tough. If they don't even know who he is, man. Majority of my friends was telling me, yo, Sean, man, you going to have the fight in your house? By the way, that dude Floyd's fighting. Is he any good? Oh, man, they don't even know who Guerrero was. So let's cut it out, man. Guerrero's a tough fighter. You understand? I'm not trying to play him. No, he's not a bum. What I'm trying to tell you is that Floyd knew this. He's flat-footed. He's easy to hit. Oh, come on. He just came off a year layoff. Well, how many year layoffs he comes off of in fight? There's nothing different, man. You understand? People, they giving him too much credit for a fighter he's supposed to be. That's like Rios. Look at Rios. Styles make fights. Rios fought a Brown. What happened? He looks silly. Because he can't fight a fighter that's going to move. You put Rios in there in front of somebody that's going to stay there, it's over for them. Alvarado moved enough in the second fight to win that fight. If Alvarado just stays there and bang with Rios, he would have got stopped again. It's just styles, man.
Sean, I got to let you go, brother. You just burned for 10 minutes. But all I can tell you is I don't agree with you. I don't agree with you. I think that Guerrero was the most credible opponent out there. And Antonio, turn your radio down.
Okay, what's up?
You're killing us. Yeah, no, I just want to finish telling Sean. I think that Guerrero was the most credible opponent out there. I don't know why he's so upset. I haven't heard Mayweather say he's not fighting Canelo. So, I think just because the fans are saying he shouldn't fight Canelo or why should he move up, I don't think that any Floyd fan should get upset or defend Floyd. Let's hear Floyd say it first. But Antonio from Albany, what's going on? What's on your mind?
What's going on, man? How's it going, man? Good fights last night, too.
Very good fights, man. Very good fights. The only fight I wasn't happy with was the Leo Santa Cruz. It was a showcase. But I guess it is what it is, man.
Well, first off, I just want to say that I do agree with Sean, you know, about the prize fighting at Mayweather, you know. I just hope that, you know, Mayweather fights somebody credible next, you know, instead of fighting somebody that's
like
coming up from 140 or 147. Like
who, though? Like who?
Next. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I said, like who?
Like, I think he should challenge himself, you know? Like Sean said, he fought De La Hoya in court at 154. How come he doesn't stay at 154 and, like, challenge himself? He should fight, like, the likes of Austin Trout or Canelo or Sergio Martinez, but he's not going to challenge himself. You know, he takes easy money.
How do you know? How do you know he's not?
He's not taking a risk. He hasn't been doing it in his last
few
fights.
But how do you know he's not going to fight Trout or Canelo or Martinez out of these six fights? We just don't know that.
Well, all right, then. So that's what I'm saying. We'll see if he does it or not. You know, I guarantee you next, he's going to fight somebody from 147. Maybe not like a Devin Alexander, you know, or maybe a Victor Ortiz. Somebody that's coming up 140, maybe 147, but I don't think he's going to take that challenge and go up to 150. You know, I mean, what do you expect from Mayweather? Fight on a count? I knew it. Everybody knew it. You know, Guerrero knew he came to the fight for a payday, man. And, you know, I don't get these fighters.
Antonio, let me ask you something.
They all come and do the same game plan. Come forward and try to get the guy in the ropes. They can't keep doing it. Cotto tried to do it. He couldn't do anything either. I just don't get these guys. Just keep doing the same game plan all the time. It's always the same thing. They think they could just push on Mayweather, get him through the ropes and just catch him right there. They can't do that. They got to switch it up a little bit, man.
But, Antonio, let me ask you something. Was Robert Guerrero, was he not the most credible opponent that Mayweather could have fought right now? Remember right that now, Canelo Alvarez and Austin Trout just fought.
After he fought Cody at 154, he could have stayed at 154. Come on. Well, if you fight guys like 18 or Berto, you think you deserve a shot at Mayweather?
Who should he have fought?
He should have fought somebody at 154. Maybe go for a Canelo at the Cotto. Cotto he lost to Mayweather, then Canelo beat Trout, and then he should have just got the winner of that fight to stay, you know,
Antonio, you're on your wild hate right now.
No, I'm
give
not
me
it,
a name. Give me a name.
Canelo Alvarez, Austin Trout, those two guys.
Time out. Antonio, you got to let me talk too, because I guess when you talk, you really can't hear me because of the mic issue or whatever. But this is the point. You're saying Canelo Alvarez and Trout. They just fought April 20th. They already had a date, my man.
Mayweather had a chance. Mayweather had a chance to fight Canelo Alvarez. He had a chance. But no, he didn't want to take that chance. He wanted to come with the excuse of fighting his mandatory at 147, Guerrero. And we knew that was going to be a piece of cake for him. I'm not hating on Mayweather. You know, once again, he did his thing.
So let me ask you one last question before I let you go. Is Bernard Hopkins coming with some bullshit fighting his mandatory and Kara Marat?
But he's not doing it now. He's fighting all these young guys coming up. He just fought Cloud.
He's fighting Kara Marat right now. That's his next fight.
Well, you can't.
He's not fighting Ward. He's not fighting Ward. He's not fighting Dawson. He's not fighting Pascal. He's not fighting Cleverly. He's not fighting Tavares Cloud rematch. He's fighting his mandatory.
All right, then, but that's going to be a challenge for him.
Let me tell you something else, Antonio. I'm going to let you go because it's mega callers. It's blowing up.
Before I let you go, I just want to give my comment on the Rosado fight real quick. Hey, after the fight, man, Rosado was so relaxed. I mean, everybody know he won the fight. He was so relaxed. So you don't think maybe the promotions, gave him a little extra money or something for that fight after that loss?
No, I think that he fought. I think that he fought to win. I think he deserved the win, and he just didn't get it.
You know what?
They robbed him. I feel it was a robbery.
He should have finished him after the knockdown. He could have, right?
I think it was a robbery, bottom line. I think there's no way that anybody's seen that. That fight any differently.
Yeah. So what do you think? You think he's going to stay at 160?
Well, he signed the Golden Boy, so let's see what they do for him. I'm going to let you go. I got another call, all right?
All right, man, yeah. I'll keep listening.
616, man. You're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this? Where you calling from? And I know you've been calling, brother. We just want to keep it to one call at a time, and I apologize. What is your name?
My name is Mario. I'm calling from Columbus, Ohio. Fight last night, Floyd showed why he's Floyd. Okay, I don't have an issue in terms of the way he fought. He fought to win. You know, you got to give him that. My question is, who do you think in the 147? Because I'm talking about 147, 154. You know, he may be too small for 154 for certain fighters, and that's just the reality of it. Okay, who in 147? I do not see anybody at 147 presenting a real challenge. Before Pacquiao got knocked out, sure, Pacquiao. But again, when Pacquiao got knocked out with Marquez, he was winning that fight. He got caught. It is what it is. Night. But who do you have in mind that's actually credible? You know, I'm a boxing fan. I don't know if I'll spend another $70 watching Floyd Mayweather fight whoever. Which I already know what's going to happen.
Great point.
One of the reasons why we watch fights is, what's going to happen? Is there a chance this guy's going to catch him? Is there a chance this guy have a whatever? But who in 147, realistically, have a chance, or even in 140. Any of those guys come up to 147. Since Floyd is the king, I don't see Floyd going to a different weight that he doesn't want to go to. Okay? But who in 147 can beat him or even present a challenge, a compelling match? I don't see anybody. You know, I mean, who do you have in mind?
I don't have anyone in mind, to be honest with you, Mario. The funniest thing is, people are discrediting Guerrero today. Yesterday, he was good enough. And yesterday, I don't think anyone else at the 147-pound division beats Guerrero the way that Mayweather did.
Well, I think this guy cannot get a break. Guerrero. He's a solid fighter. That's all he is. He's a solid fighter. He's decent. You know, I mean, he's a world class, okay, but we're not talking about world class. There's a dozen world class fighters out there. There's only one Floyd Mayweather. There's only one Andre Ward, for example. I mean, if Andre Ward was 147, that'd be a hell of a fight, but he's not, you know. But it's one of those things where, you know, Guerrero is decent. You know, he's a decent fighter. He's okay. He's serviceable.
But Mario, let me ask you a question, Mario. Mario, let me ask you a question, because the big thing on Twitter is, oh, this was a Mitch match. We knew who was going to win. He's cherry-picking his opponents. Did you mention anybody at the 147-pound division that it would not have been a mismatch? That you would have not picked Floyd Mayweather to win?
Well, you know, people talking about him, you know, Guerrero being a mismatch. I mean, now we can say it's a mismatch. Okay, now we can say, oh, yeah, it's a mismatch. But, I mean, I knew Guerrero was coming, but his chances of winning was very slim. I mean, we all know that. I think everybody knew that. But you were looking at, okay, is he going to tag Floyd? Is he going to give him a little hard time? I think that's what we're looking for. It's not a matter of whether Guerrero was going to beat him. I don't think there was a question unless he gets caught. You know, unless Mayweather gets caught, like he got caught mostly. I mean, you know, the chances of that happening again is slim to none. But, you know, Guerrero to me was an okay fighter. I still think he's an okay fighter. You know, I don't think he was going to
be. Mario, let's wrap this up because I'm getting a million calls. Before this fight took place yesterday night, were you upset with the decision to fight Robert Guerrero?
I was indifferent about it. I'll be honest with you. It's just another guy that he fights. Because really, nobody out in 147 really was a threat. You know, so I was like, okay,
all right.
Sure.
Well, look,
you know,
just give us a call a little bit later in the show. We're probably going to do another 3 hours. We're only into the first half an hour, so it's no sweat. Give us a call. Let's free up the lines a little bit for all the people that are trying to get in, okay?
Thanks for taking my call, brother.
No problem, man. Call us back. 374.
Hey, how you doing? This is 347.
Yeah, 347. I apologize.
Yes, this is Miguel Santana from the Bronx.
Miguel Santana. What's up, brother? From the Boogie Down. Talk to me, man.
Well, yeah, listen, man. I mean, in terms of last night's fight, as it relates to Floyd Mayweather, he put on a boxing clinic. He really showed that throughout the fight for the most part. And, you know, I hear a lot of folks out there not giving him credit for I guess, taking the fight. But, you know, there's no other candidates out there at that weight class that can really put on that type of fight to be competitive with Floyd Mayweather. Now, what people are saying is, let's put together the Canelo fight. Now, if they do put that fight together in September, that'll be a good fight. Now, Floyd, I still think, will outclass Canelo. Canelo's good, but he's not at the level of Floyd Mayweather. Mayweather has a lot of experience, and it shows. What are your thoughts about that?
I'm going to go ahead and free up the lines. Just keep listening to the live feed, and we will answer that. But I agree with you, man. I mean, Well, I don't agree about I do agree that he probably would still beat Canelo as well. Would Canelo present some problems? Yes, but yesterday Floyd showed just how fast he is. We all thought he lost a step in the Cotto fight, and he proved us wrong, man. He really did. So I don't know how that fight goes. I'm not saying that he's not going to fight Canelo until he says he's not fighting Canelo.
No, you're right. You're right. You're right. I mean, I think it's up in the air, but it's a big money fight. You know, both fighters will stand to make a lot of money from it. It's just a matter of when. So, you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Miguel, Miguel, think about it this way before you go.
Okay.
He's got a 6-fight deal. Any smart man is going to fight Canelo on the 5th fight with the 6th fight for the rematch in case he loses.
Well, that's a possibility.
So I'm not even looking forward to the Canelo fight yet.
But by then, you know, Canelo may have gotten the experience to really catch Floyd on the decline. So that's the question. I think Floyd may
have... But isn't that what people want anyway? Don't you want to see him lose anyway?
Who, Floyd? At this
point,
I'd rather
see
him
lose.
You know, go up against all the best that are out there. But I like to see him go undefeated.
All right. Well, thanks for the call, Miguel. You can definitely call back a little bit later, man. We accept all calls here, man. And thanks for being part of the show.
Thank you for having me on. Thanks.
All right. 254. Live on the Boxing Voice. Where are you calling from?
Hey, what's good? I'm calling from Killeen, Texas.
All right, man. A lot of people calling in from Texas today, man. So what's on your mind and what's your name?
Hey, my name is Darnell. Hey, my main thing is I think Mayweather fought an excellent fight. I think why people want him to fight Canelo when Canelo came in his last fight at 179? Why nobody screams for Canelo to fight Martinez, Ward? If Canelo can come in at 179, why he not fighting Andre Ward? I think the best Mayweather is 147, period.
I agree with you, man. I agree as far as I don't see why people are like taking out the pitchforks and lighting their torches and standing in front of Floyd Mayweather's mansion saying he must fight Canelo.
It's crazy.
Get,
you know what?
The I get main the thing argument,
is,
though.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Ness.
No, but hold on, Darnell. I get the argument.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, hold on. You fought De La Hoya at 154.
Got it.
You fought Cotto at 154. You fought those guys for money.
Got it.
Well, guess what? We got a guy that's at 154 that you can fight, that you can probably make the same amount of money, if not more, and pay-per-view buys that you did with De La Hoya, possibly break a record. But to the naked eye, it seems like maybe Floyd is scared. That's what the people are grasping on. But I don't think so. I think he's waiting, bro. He just came out. This is his first fight out of jail, first fight back with his father. He's just wetting his beak, getting his feet wet.
That's a fair point. Everybody, man, everybody who's everybody thought this guy lost his leg. He proved everybody again last night why he's the best fighter. I think he was smart in not going with Roger, obviously, if something was different. I just want to, you know, I don't know who he should fight next. The bottom line is people don't value that zero. It don't matter. This era, last era, everybody wants these super fights. And that's about it. That's all it is. Everybody just wants super fights.
Before we let you go, I'm asking everyone this question.
Okay.
Was Robert Guerrero the most available and credible opponent at 147 that Floyd could have fought yesterday?
Yes. There's no other. Yes. I can't
all
make
right,
an argument
well,
about anybody else,
call.
Believe me.
Well, thanks for the call, and definitely give us a call back. We're going to be on for about 3 hours.
All right, yeah.
All right, well, that number is 201-688-7127, or you can Skype us at The Boxing Voice. Don't be discouraged. I've seen a lot of you guys calling in. We're just trying to keep it to one person at a time to get the clarity of every call nice. So I got a message here. They're asking me to read this on the show. It says, Big ATL, what's up, brother? Give me good, 1 minute, man? ATL, before you go into your rant. Let me just read this for one of these listeners here. They say Mayweather went into retirement when the 147-pound division was at its prime. Cotto, Mosley, Forrest, Margarito, etc. Floyd mentioned a 40-year-old Casamayor and, I don't know, Push Guerrero. I have no clue what that means. I guess I'll just do my disclosure that that was Balkan from the UK. But ATL, I know you want to defend your boy. I seen you go. They were at a witch hunt for you and Mayweather on Twitter. Go for it, brother.
Nah, man. I just, a couple days, man. Like, you know, we know what it is, miss. I know you getting so many calls, man. People just want to see Floyd lose. They want to put him at some type of physical disadvantage to where, because he's so skillful, man, whether it's a guy that's way bigger than him or a guy that's doing suspect things, they don't care, man. If you can't appreciate that masterpiece, even if you say Guerrero was a B-plus, B-fighter, Floyd made him look like an F. An F, man. Can't nobody say he's an F, dude. I mean, like, what do y'all talk about? And they talk about Canelo. What people don't get is he went up to 54 to fight guys that started at much lower weights than 54. Canelo is big, man. I'm not saying he won't fight him, but that boy is big, and he's 22, only going to get bigger, man. He's a bigger guy than Oscar and Cotto ever were, man. I mean, I don't know, understand what people don't get about that. They got weight divisions for a reason. If I was Floyd, I'd stay at 47, keep whooping ass, and retire. Period. That's it.
But see, the thing is about it, though, is you got to understand, at the end of the day, he's saying all these things in the media. Like, that's the problem, is he keeps talking about these tests, and tests come in different shapes and sizes, you know what I mean? I give my hat off to Guerrero, and honestly, I don't think there's anybody else in the division that can do better. I mean, the point Ness is trying to make is that there was no one else that would have, you know, made any sense, and that's true. And I don't know if there's anyone else that could do better or wouldn't get chin checked. But when you're coming, when you're putting a number on your retirement fights, you have to at some point realize that the biggest and best fights out there are much harder than you know, than they would have been in the past. Oscar De La Hoya fought at 154 before the Mayweather fight. He had already moved up. Floyd made him come down.
Mario, you're penalizing Floyd for being great, man.
No, I'm not.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, he needs to go up and fight 160. You understand the guy has to try to gain weight to make 54, and he still comes in under the limit?
He doesn't have to fight anybody. My point is, when you're saying you want to give the fans the biggest and the best around, and Mayweather said he would fight Canelo like a year ago. Like, what happened? He got too good? He saw him fight Trout, and now he doesn't want to fight him? He said that with his own words. That's my only
point. Mario.
The dude is 36,
When did Mayweather said he wasn't going to fight Floyd? Hold on, ATL. Maybe I'm wrong here, but has Mayweather came out and said he's not fighting Canelo?
Well, Karen Mulvaney on our show on Thursday said, and I agree with him completely, that Mayweather is already setting the stage to not fight him, kind of in the same manner that he did with Pacquiao. He's saying, well, I'm a 147 fighter, and I only fought the 154 division because it was Cotto's division. Where's that give and take? You know what I'm saying? He fought Cotto at 154 because Cotto was a smaller fighter. So then at the end of the day, they're still all things that belong on Floyd's side of the table. That's my only point. I'm not trying to discredit him. I'm not saying he's not the best in the world. But let's keep it real. All of these little prerequisites that are going on, they're still to Floyd's advantage. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're not. He made Haddon come up. He made De La Hoya come down. He went up to fight a smaller Cotto. The weight had nothing to do with it. And Floyd knew that. It wasn't any more advantage for Cotto than it was a disadvantage. You know what I mean?
Are you serious, Mario?
I'm dead serious. At the end of the day, no. Cotto had no chance in that fight, and Floyd knew that the only thing that 154 pound did was not let Mayweather stop Cotto. That's it. That's all it did. Was Cotto didn't get stopped.
Him muscling him on the ropes or anything, Mario.
He would have been the bigger fighter no matter what. He would have been the bigger fighter no matter what.
See how you do, dude.
He would have been the bigger fighter no matter what.
Oh my God.
Mario, let me ask you something.
Yeah, sure.
Why would you take the word of Carol Mulvaney when that's just his assumption? At the end of the day, Mayweather has not said it yet. Why are we crucifying him? And he's only into the first fight of his deal, his first fight back, and he hasn't physically said it yet.
Because we've been here too many times, Ness. We've been here too many times. He said he's going to fight in September, right? And I didn't believe him, and I don't know many people that did. And all of a sudden, he hurt his hand yesterday. There's things going on. I mean,
what do you mean all of a sudden? Never, his thing is swelling.
I guess.
All of a sudden?
Look, he was never going to fight in September. I don't know
who. How do you know
that, Mario? You're looking into a crystal ball, man. How do you know that?
Because I've been here before. Everyone's been here before.
Mario's butthurt.
He's not gonna. No, I'm not butthurt. I swear. It was a good fight for Floyd. He showed a lot of things. But my only point is, don't come out and say you're gonna make this final legacy stomp, and then you're fighting Devin Alexander. Like, come on. Like, that's some bullshit. Okay, guys. So, like, let's be real about it. You're telling him ACL. You're saying he should stay at 147 and retire? That's ridiculous. Like, because he's – look, I didn't say that
What's
Floyd should be fighting
– division now?
Look, everyone expects more from Floyd. That's the problem. And that's what y'all don't want to admit. That's what ATL never wants to admit, is at the end of the day, people expect more from Floyd because he is the best.
He turns B-plus fighters into Fs, man. That's giving you more. Y'all don't understand boxing, man.
So tell me, what do you think his best shot, like, what do you think his biggest test is right now?
I think
there
it's
is
time,
none.
Man. Father Time, dude. He's 36. He's
so
like one hungry guy who grew up wanting to beat him, dog. That's hard. And they're world class. That's hard.
So
he's 36. Man, y'all act like Floyd don't age. Just everybody else gets old. Everybody else out their prime. He's not in his prime, man.
No, I never said he was in his prime. I mean, he's a tremendous
he's like
fighter.
A world class, 6-time champion, and made him look like an F. And you got a problem?
No, nobody's talking about last night's fight. He beat the best 147-pounder. I have no problem with the Guerrero fight. All these people that are jumping ship today and saying it was a bullshit. I'm not. I'm telling y'all. I have a problem with everyone after Guerrero. That's my problem. Is I feel you're talking about what's wrong with him wiping out the division. He just did. He just wiped out the division. That's what he did last night.
So basically, hold on, ATL. Hold on, ATL. So basically, Mara, you're saying he just beat the best guy at 147, so he's got to move up in weight to entertain you.
Yeah, essentially, yeah. I want to see the biggest test for him. That's what I want to see. If he wants
to
move
up, why are you not pushing Andre Ward?
Because
Andre Ward to move up.
Because Andre Ward is not Floyd Mayweather. If y'all can't tell the distinction between Floyd Mayweather and other great fighters, I'm sorry. I don't know what to tell y'all. Like, I'm sorry y'all want to pay.
ATL.
Yeah.
I know you didn't get much talk because Mario wants to hit you with the bullshit.
Let me get to some calls
and call me back, brother.
Okay, I'll hit you back. All right.
773, you're live on the Boxer Voice. Who's this?
Yo, what's up, man? It's me, Tony.
Tony, what's up? Where you from, the Shy?
Yeah, what's up, bro? I'm calling from a different number, man. We're good.
I see that. Holy damn, that was like 8 calls right there. Go for it, Tony. Talk to me, man.
Nah, man. You know, the reason I got Mario's back on this, and I got to disagree with you, Ness. I don't even know if you disagree with Mario, but the thing about Floyd is that there's a pattern with Floyd, with him choosing opponents. You know what I'm saying? Like, for instance, when he was in the 147s in 2008, when he had Miguel Cotto, he had Mosley, Paul Williams, all those guys. You know what I'm saying? He decided he wanted to retire, man. He fights 140-pounder Ricky Hatton, then he retires. You know, and no disrespect to Floyd, because Floyd did his thing last night. You know, he outclassed Robert Guerrero, who I thought was a solid opponent. I thought he was a solid opponent, man. You know, he was a legit opponent. You know, but it's just what Floyd does. What he does is he insults the sensibilities of hardcore boxing fans. Now, I don't know if ATL considers himself a hardcore boxing fan, but for him to not see that, that what Floyd does is business first, as opposed to this fighting for fans, he don't know what he's talking about. And then he obviously fights just for the paycheck, where, you know, I mean, come on, there's nothing wrong with that, but don't come out here talking about you're the greatest fighter, you know, so slice, you know, don't sit there and say you're better than Sugar Ray Robinson. Don't even compare yourself to Ali. Come on, man. I never saw a Sugar Ray Robinson fight. You know what I'm saying? But I could just go. I trust a lot of those historians who have seen him say Robinson's the greatest. Muhammad Ali, come on, man. You know, don't come out here saying that you're fighting all these, you know, B-plus fighters. You know what I'm saying? And saying that you're the greatest of all time. He came out of retirement, fought Juan Manuel Marquez, okay, instead of fighting Pacquiao. And what was his reasoning? Because Juan Manuel Marquez had a country behind him. Okay? He had Mexico. In that case, how come he didn't fight Margarito? They fought the same country? Nah. He instead of fighting a guy his size or bigger, he's going to call out a guy two weight classes lower. And that's the shit we don't forget, man. Like, Ness, man, sometimes you be disappointing me, man. How could you forget this, man? You know,
I didn't forget it, but what you got to remember is this, Tony.
Yeah.
Margarito was signed to Top Rank. That fight wasn't never going to happen anywhere.
But how about the other guys? Paul Williams. I mean, that's just one guy, man. That's,
he was an Al Heyman fighter at the time.
Paul Williams, Sugar Shane Mosley.
Fought Cotto.
Say what?
I said he fought Mosley, he fought Cotto, and Paul Williams was a Al Heyman fighter.
Well, he fought Cotto, you know, past his prime. You know what I'm saying? I mean, come on, man. He gave him a good fight.
Antonio, let me ask you a question. I mean, excuse me, Tony.
Yeah, what's up?
Let me ask you a question before I let you go. Two questions. Was Guerrero the best 147-pounder that Floyd could have fought yesterday?
Yes, absolutely.
All right,
I
got
to debate that, but guess what? Hey, Ness. Hello? Mm-hmm. We're talking about this era of boxing, right? Which is kind of sad that, and I love the guy. He's one of my favorite fighters, but this is the era of boxing where Bernard Hopkins, at 48 years old, won a fucking belt. This is the era we're talking about, okay? Name another era where a 48-year-old is going to sit there win a belt against a young guy. Come on, man. Floyd is great. Don't get me wrong, man. He got a lot of he's highly skilled, man. He's up there, man. To sit there and say he's not, you know, but like I said, man, I don't put him on the Mount Everest of fighters because you got to prove it against the best guys of your era. He had a chance to do that, but he decided to go into retirement like a little bitch. And you know this, Ness. You know what I'm saying? I mean, come on, man. These are just facts, bro. Like Angel Garcia said, man, the sky's too big, whatever the fuck he said. You know, to hide the truth. But that's what Floyd does. He insults me, a guy who used to pay for his fights, man. I don't pay for his fights. You know what I'll do? I'll buy a case of beer and go to my boy's house and watch it. I'm not gonna fucking pay no more money for watching Floyd fight. Not out of my pocket. You know what I'm saying?
But Tony, be honest, is that because you feel there's no one that can beat him?
No, it's not. It's that I wanted him to, you know, I think that there's a chance. This is what it is. It's the whole spirit of it. That's what I'm saying. It's the whole spirit of the of competition. That's what I'm talking about. This dude, I think, and I'm going to be honest with you, had he fought Cotto, I think he would have beat Cotto in a day. I think he probably would have beat Paul Williams. You know what I'm saying? In a perfect world, fuck the top.
But remember, hey, Tony, I'm going to let you go because I'm just getting too many calls. But remember this. I'm going to leave you with this. When you wanted him to fight Cotto, Cotto was signed to Top Rank. But give us a call back a little later, and you know you get more time to just shine.
I got you.
Mario, you let me down, man. You quickly turned into this Floyd hater because he beat your boy
Guerrero. I'm not a Floyd hater. I don't want to be called that because that's not what I am. I don't hate Floyd. Go ahead.
646, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this? 646, you're live. 6. All right. Craig, what's up, brother? I know you've been calling, man. We take it one at a time. You're live on the Boxing Voice. Where are you calling from? Craig? And Craig fell off. For anybody that wants to call in, if you don't know, we got one. 636, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
Yo, what's up, man? It's Ant-Man, and I didn't want to speak on, you know, the whole Mayweather.
Ant from where? Ant from where?
Yeah, man, from the St. Louis, bro, from St. Louis.
So, are you happy that Devin Alexander might be Floyd Mayweather's next opponent for September?
Not really, man. I mean, more of it comes from, you know, Devin, you know, I'm not really too much a fan of him. If it came down to Midwest, like, boxes in general, it's like, you know, the Kid Chocolate, the Andre Durrell, whenever he comes back, and, like, Anthony Durrell. But when it comes to Devin, I mean, he got to prove himself, yo. Like, I mean, the dude, you know, he cried in the Bradley fight talking about, my eyes get burned. Like, come on, man. Like, I'm just not a fan of that, you know. So he has to prove himself.
All right, so one more question. Was Robert Guerrero the best 147-pounder that Floyd could have fought yesterday?
I'll go ahead and say he is, because not only did he, you know, talk a lot and, you know, Ruben Guerrero going crazy, whatever, he really showed that he really wanted to fight. It just wasn't there. Like, I mean, in all honesty, he had the height. He had the length advantage. The guy's a rangy southpaw, you know, and he said he was going to do a lot with the overhand. I didn't see the overhand left, you know, like all night. All night I didn't see it. He didn't, you know, he didn't do his double jabs or nothing. Anything that he was talking about, he didn't do it. But that was because of Floyd's greatness, his speed, his ring generalship. I mean, the guy was just bar none amazing last night. When you let 60% of your power punch is just something special. I don't care who you face. You know, it doesn't matter. Like, that's a top-level guy. Because Robert, what is he worth? Six different championships or something like that? I could be wrong.
Six-time world champion.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. The guy, you know, he's not no walk, you know, no walk in the park, no bum. To any other boxer, he's hard. He's hard work. But Floyd makes him look, you know, easy work, like he always says, you know. So, I mean, you got to look at it on that note, is Floyd is great. And a lot of people don't like to admit it, but the dude is a master boxer. Actually, give him credit. Floyd Senior came back into his camp, you know, his free throw, and he let him know how it is, you know what I'm saying? You get back to your defense, your craft, and it shows. I mean, people say in the Cotto fight, yeah, Cotto, hey, I'm going to score myself, okay? Cotto did his thing, don't get me wrong. And it wasn't just because it was 154 and the weight range, blah, blah, blah. It was more, you know, Cotto having a great game plan. He got up for that fight. And Pedro Diaz and him had a, you know, like I said, a pretty good game plan and what they was going to do. Set everything up with the jab, because Floyd is a bit susceptible to getting hit with the jab if you have great timing and, you know how to position yourself in the ring. So, I don't know. I just think it's crazy that people don't give, you know, that man his credit.
Well, Ant, thanks for the call. We got tons of callers calling in, but we'll be here for hours, so just call back, brother. 317, you're live on the Boxing Voice with me and Mario. We're not getting to talk much because the fans want to talk, and that's how we love it, man. What is on your mind, and where you calling from?
What's good? This is Black Superman from Indianapolis. What's good?
Black Superman, what's good, man? Long time no hear.
Yeah, man.
What's going on, man?
Crazy,
I'm pretty sure you're seeing the hate.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure you've seen the hate on Twitter and you're hearing it on the show.
Yeah, yeah, I've been hearing it. And Sean, man, that's my guy. But Sean, man, I swear, like I said on Twitter, Floyd must have done him like Eminem done standing outside of that concert, man. He waited for that autograph and didn't get it because his dislike or disdain for the man is unreal, man. I just look at it like this. I went into the fight knowing that Guerrero wasn't going to win. Did I know that the challenge he presented was going to be as weak as it was? No. I mean, he talked a good game, and I've seen Guerrero fight. Guerrero's a good fighter. But I knew that if Floyd came in his peak, and I'll tell you what, the reason why Floyd was so good last night, and I tell people this all the time, the greater challenge presented to him, the more he rises to that occasion. When Floyd was out on his feet against Sugar Shane Mosley, he came back after that round and dominated every single round after that. When Floyd got knocked down, and yes, it was a knockdown against Zab Judah, he came back and dominated every round after that. When Floyd got the fight against Castillo and came back for that second fight, he came back and dominated every fight, I mean every round of the next fight. When he fought Diego Corrales, which was his first big challenge, so-called, he dominated that fight. So when there's actually a challenge in front of him, that's when he's not boring. That's when he goes in there and he takes it to the guy. If you look at Floyd, everybody wants him to move up to 154 and fight Canelo, which I don't have a problem with that. I don't have a problem with him fighting Canelo. I personally don't like him at 154 because he doesn't carry any power up to that weight class, and I just don't think that he would be able to keep Canelo off of him. But saying that, when you saw that fight last night, Guerrero looked way bigger than Floyd Mayweather. And Guerrero is the guy who has had two fights at 147. Floyd Mayweather has been there for about 10 years or so now. You know, he's not a big man. So for everybody who wants him to go up and fight guys like Austin Trout is two fights away from being a middleweight. Canelo is a couple fights from being a middleweight. So, okay, if he says, I'll fight Canelo, but Canelo has to come to 147, what's everybody going to say then? What are people going to say to Mario? Is that okay? If he says, I'll fight Canelo, but Canelo has to come to 147, is that okay?
I don't think so, no.
It's not okay. And why is it not okay?
I mean, you just tip the scales in too much of one person's favor, then the matchup itself loses all its luster. I mean, you might as well just not have it.
So
basically, Mario... Black Superman, I got a bunch of people on the line, so I'm going to let you go, but I'm going to definitely defend your point against Mario.
All right, brother.
So basically, Mario, you're saying it's not a good fight unless he's in a disadvantage.
Unless they're both
a bigger man.
Unless they're both comfortable. They've got to both be comfortable. At the end of the day, Floyd is much more capable. Floyd is much more capable of moving up than Canelo is of moving down because it's easier to what? Move up, and it's harder to what? Move down. Oh, we all learned something today.
But Mario,
you don't learn nothing on the boxing voice.
Let me ask you this. What was Floyd's weight when he fought Cotto? 150, right?
Something like that, yeah, I think so. If you know for sure, then I agree.
So it's not easier. But we got another call on the line all the way from Connecticut. CT, go for it.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Hey, the way Mayweather fought last night, there's nobody going to beat that dude, man. And what you guys think about the way he fought? I mean, I didn't think he was going to bring it back to how he used to fight. I didn't think he had the legs in him anymore.
That's what I've been saying all day. Instead of people enjoying what he did and the fact that he proved people wrong, showing that his legs was still there, that his timing was still there, that straight right, how many straight – man, he made Guerrero look so bad. And people are not enjoying that. They're like, oh, that was too easy. We want him to fight Canelo.
He'll make Canelo look bad too. It's just – you know, his quickness is something you rarely see that in boxing. His reflexes are sick. There's no way. It's so hard to beat that dude when he's on his game like that. And to tell you the truth, I think Guerrero fought good. I think he gets anybody else in the welterweight division trouble. But it's just the fact that Mayweather, with his timing, his accuracy, and his reflexes, just told a story through the whole fight. It was just an amazing performance. But, you know, good kudos to Guerrero, too. He fought well, like I said. I think he had a good game plan. It just, his Mayweather's accuracy And like I said, his reflexes and speed, that was the big difference. There's nobody's going to beat this dude. I knew
CT.
Mayweather's been... Huh?
Two questions before we let you go, because this show is extremely high volume on calls.
Okay.
My first question is, was Robert Guerrero the best possible opponent available and at 147 for Floyd to fight yesterday?
I don't know if he was the best possible opponent, but I think he deserved it. You know what I mean? I would definitely style match. I would like to
see him. Wait a minute.
Oh.
That's great. You opened up a can of worms. So who do you feel was a better opponent at 147?
Stylistically, I would like to see him in there with a Bradley. Somebody who's got pretty good reflexes himself, who's going to be relentless, go to the body. You know, that drive, you know, that I think Bradley's very mentally tough too. You know what I mean? He's got a pretty good speed himself. I would like to see him in there with Bradley. If you get that smart cast.
That's a good fight, but we also said available, and we know no top-ranked fighter is available to Floyd Mayweather.
Right. Okay. I'm not sure. I have to think about that. I would maybe put him in there with Canelo if he wants to go up to 154, but I think he'll make Canelo look bad. I think Canelo's very strong, but, you know, I've seen some lapses with him against Trout, and if he's going to have them type of problems with Trout, I think Mayweather's going to make him look even worse.
Last question before I let you go. If that fight versus Canelo happens, where would you rather see it? Would you rather Floyd move up or force Canelo to come down?
I have Floyd move up because I don't think Canelo can make 147.
All right, CT, definitely give us a call back. We're going to be here for a couple of hours.
All right, thanks a lot, man.
All right, fight fans, phone lines cleared up. You could definitely call in. I'll try and run through some of this stuff. 15,880 people in attendance for the Floyd Mayweather show last night. Mayday, 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 mayday. Robert Guerrero needs an ambulance. We got another caller from unknown, and I'm afraid this may be Liam. Liam, is this you?
No.
All right,
no,
who's this?
It's Lewis, man.
Who?
Lewis.
Lewis, man.
Go for it, Lewis. What's on your mind?
Yeah, man, just a quick point. Thanks for taking my call. I thought the performance was a masterpiece. It was one of the best displays I've ever seen. And I was really surprised at the fans booing. And some of them walking out halfway through. I just want to know what you guys think of that.
I agree with you totally. I think it was a masterful performance. I think he made a guy that we all thought would give Mayweather some sort of problems. He negated everything Robert Guerrero brought to the ring. The referee let them fight in close, and that still didn't even affect Mayweather. He was still fighting in close, shooting combinations on Guerrero, landing his uppercut more than Guerrero. He just made Guerrero look like he did not belong in the ring with him. But, Lewis, we're going to let you go. We got a tons of calls. You could definitely give us a call back later.
Sure.
So, Mario, maybe 12-round unanimous decision.
Let me respond to that real quick. The thing is fans booing, like, I understand why they booed last night. I do. Me personally, that was a great fight. I was thoroughly entertained. I mean, yes, it was somewhat one-sided, but at the end of the day, it was a masterful performance. Any young fighters out there should get that tape and, you know, really highlight some of those key portions of it. But I understand why they booed. I do. But I think people are misinterpreting that as it being like a boring fight. I think it was due to the competitiveness. I think people have much more of a problem with how uncompetitive it was as opposed to the actual performance itself because, I mean, we saw blood last night. You know, we saw people getting rocked. The percentages of landed power shots were up there. You know, on paper, it was a good fight, and I felt it was still. I've seen it twice already, and I was entertained.
Well, a lot of things that a lot of the fans already touched on. Mayweather landed 60% of his punches. We all know he made $32 million. We all know that he said he's coming back in September, although he has a hand injury. And we all know that the Canelo fight is being rumored. He never said he wouldn't fight Canelo. But until we get another caller that wants to continue to talk about Mayweather, I do want to put the spotlight. Well, we got another caller. 626, where are you calling from? Turn your radio down. Turn your radio down.
Sorry about that, man.
All right. 626, where are you calling from? What's your name?
Yeah, Vincent from LA.
Excuse me?
Vincent from Los Angeles.
Vincent from Los Angeles. What's going on? You got a really bad connection there. You might want to get by a window. Yep, totally bad connection. So, Abner Mars, I picked him. You picked him. Vic did not. We got another caller. We got two more callers. 646, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
How you doing? This is Joe. Calling from Bronx,
New York. Joe, where you calling from? The BX?
Yeah, New York.
What's going on, brother?
Yeah, I just want to comment on the Mayweather versus Guerrero fight. I thought Mayweather put on a masterful performance. I think, like, people that's trying to talk about
his credit,
fight nobody, etc. I think that's ridiculous. I feel like people shouldn't hype these guys up, and then when Mayweather makes them look like bums, then they say, like, oh, Mayweather didn't fight nobody. But in reality, it's just how Mayweather making them look, you know what I'm saying?
I agree with you, man. You're spot on.
Just like Donaire and Regal. You know what I'm saying?
We're losing you. We're losing you, BX.
Hello? You hear me?
Yeah, we got you. Yes.
Yeah. I'm saying, like, don't hype these guys up, Mario. Don't hype them up. And then Mayweather make him look like a bum, and then you want to, you know what I'm saying? Then you want to talk about, oh, he let the Pacquiao slip away. Now he's about to let the Canelo fight slip away. Pacquiao said no to a $50 million drug test. Not only he said no to a $50 million drug test, he fought six fighters since then, and he still hasn't taken the test. You know what I'm saying? So Pacquiao, to me, needs to be blamed. You know what I'm saying? And that's just how I feel. And you touched on something earlier, Ness, about the weight. I think most people, they want him to go up in weight, but they feel like that's the only way that could give Mayweather his first loss. They banking on weight. You see Jim Lampy, he go up there, and you're talking about Mayweather should fight GGG, Sergio, or Canelo if he want to put the stamps on his legacy. You know what I'm saying? So that's all they banking on, weight. They know skills. Nobody can match him. Nobody.
Well, you make excellent points. You must be a long-time boxing fan. We're glad that you called into the show. We're going to be here for a couple hours, so definitely give us a call back. We want to free up the lines for some new callers. All right, brother? 315, you're live on a Boxing Voice. Who are you? Where are you calling from?
Calling from Syracuse.
Syracuse, what's going on? What's your name, brother?
Yeah, man, this is me, Mighty, man. I was calling about the whole Mayweather-Canelo thing, man. I think Mayweather too small for Canelo, man. Like, when you fought Cotto, he came in at 151. When you fought Oscar De La Hoya, he came in at 150. Like, he never made a legit 154 in his life. You know what I mean?
You make a great point. You're preaching to the choir. The guy you need to get at and whip the guns out as Mario. He's on the line. Mario, he's talking to you, brother.
Well, I just think that at the end of the day, Pacquiao did it. You know what I'm saying? Like, all the greatest fighters in the world take the biggest test that they possibly can. Is Canelo?
Like, every fighter may wear the fault if they legit weight. Pacquiao fought him at a catch weight. That's all.
And what's wrong with the Canelo catch weight? What's wrong with them meeting in the middle of 147, 154?
They'll take all the fault out of here. They're going to make a stupid like, oh, Mayweather fought Canelo at catch weight. He ain't going to get all the parts for that, man.
No.
Hey, Syracuse.
Yeah.
Syracuse, let me ask you something. How many fights did Pacquiao fight at 154?
Never. He never came to 154.
No, he fought once. He fought Margarito. I mean, it was a catch weight, but all right, it was still the division.
So why are you mad at Mayweather? He did it twice.
Like, that's an easy fight. Like, Margarito? Like, really?
What happened to all the Mayweather fans calling Canelo an easy fight earlier? It was the same thing Clean said in the YouTube chat. Is everybody was saying that Canelo was easy work a year ago, and all of a sudden he's too big? Like, I don't get this transition, guys. Like, man, all the Mayweather fans were so down to get that fucking payday.
They're trying to find a way for Mayweather to lose, man. Like, that's
ridiculous. But that's the point. That's the point.
Fight night. He come in like at 160 or something like that. And, like, Mayweather come in like at 146.
I understand that.
Like, barely make 147.
I understand that, but let me tell you, it's not about making Floyd lose. It's about presenting the possibility in the ring that Floyd to lose. Because I don't know about you, but the worst kinds of fight in the world to me are the ones that I know who's going to win before they go into the ring. I don't understand why people want to see that. Like, it's crazy to me. It's ridiculous. But what's wrong with Floyd going into the ring with something against him? Like, what's wrong with him not having one single advantage on his side? Because he goes in the ring with almost every advantage. And the size advantages are ridiculous because he negates him with speed. He negates him with footwork. He negates him with agility, with physicalness, with athleticism. That's what I'm saying is he gets Canelo in.
I don't fit you with that. Like, I seen the post-conference yesterday, and I heard Richard Schaefer, and he was like, oh, yeah, man, I think, you know what I mean, Mayweather should fight Canelo, man. I think that's the only one that can give me his first L. Like, it's on YouTube. You can go watch it, man.
No, I've seen
it. I think it's something fits with that, man. I think if they do fight, man, and it's a close fight, they're going to give it to Canelo because they're trying to make him the next cash cow. It's just something fits you, man. Like, you look at the interview and you look at Oscar De La Hoya, and it's the only thing that dude talk about. Like,
look,
Canelo, man, he's ready for Mayweather. I don't know, man. Like,
if that kind of corruptiveness, look, let me tell you, if that kind of corruptiveness exists in the sport, which I don't believe it does at all, but if it does, Floyd Mayweather and Al Haymon are as powerful as anyone. So whatever kind of pull Golden Boy has, don't worry, Floyd's back is covered. Floyd is not going to get robbed in that fight if he does not want to get robbed in that fight. Trust me.
You, man.
Al Haymon has got his back.
He was 36 years old, man. The dude is up there in age, man.
And he beat arguably the best 147 pounder last night.
Like, middleweight. That's about to be official middleweight in two or three fights. It's ridiculous, man. They asking for too much, man.
Well, let's step on the ball and fight him already, then. If he's going to be too big in a year, then fight him.
Yeah, I guess you should retire then, because that's the fact, man. You should retire, man, because Canelo needs to come to 147, man.
I have no problem with that.
He wants to come to 147, or they can fight out of catch with a 150. I'll take that.
You know what? You made the best point. You made the best point so far today. If he's not going to fight the test, he's not going to fight 50-50, retire. I'd rather never see him fight again than see him fight Devin Alexander. I'll tell you that right now.
Okay.
Well, Syracuse, thanks for the call, brother.
What about America?
No, not at all.
Hey, Syracuse, we got to let you go. We got a bunch of other callers, man. Call us back. We're going to be here for a few hours.
Although America could test him with the footwork and speed. That's all I'm saying.
626, you're live on a Boxing Voice. Who's this?
I don't have a connection again, man. I'm calling back, trying to get a better connection on this bitch. Do you hear me?
Sounds better. Way better.
Yeah, we hear you perfect now.
I hear you, man.
You just went back into the Matrix. 559, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Oh, man.
559, turn your radio down. Tell us where you're calling from.
My name is Jason, calling from Houston.
Jason from Houston?
Yes.
H-Town in the house. What's going on, brother?
Hey, what's going on, man? I just wanted to share my thoughts on this whole Mayweather-Canelo thing. And the issue is, I think people don't really give enough credit for Floyd, and they really know how good he is, but it seems like they want to see him fight Canelo so bad, it seems like they're impatient. You know what I'm saying? Like, the man just beat arguably the best 147-pounder right now. So, I mean, people just got to be patient, man. You feel where I'm coming from?
Oh, I feel you 100%. I don't even think Canelo's ready yet. I mean, he looked really good in the Trout fight. He made me a believer. But one fight?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, one opponent, fight. Like, people's jumping the gun so fast. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I agree, man.
And, what do you guys think of this? If Canelo was to go down to, if they were to do something in the contract clause to make it so where on fight night, Canelo can't be above 154, do you think that fight could happen
that'll
like
be
that
impossible.
On fight night?
That'll be impossible. What'd he say his name was, Mario? What's your name again, H-Town?
Jason.
Jason, that'll be impossible. Canelo weighed 171 versus Trout. He would kill himself if he can't get above 154. He would
that's what I'm trying to say, though. That would just be a huge, you know, disadvantage. Unfortunately, you take that fight, and the dude's going to weigh 170-something pounds. And I'm just being honest about it. Man, I'm just being honest about it.
You know what you're being? Aside from being honest, you're being a person with a heart.
You know what
I'm
saying?
I don't think none of us liked when Chavez used to come into the ring weighing 20 pounds heavier than his opponents. Now we want Floyd to do it. I think it's unfair, man. I think it's totally unfair. I'm going to let you go. We're going to be here for another 2 hours, so give us a call back. We got to free it up for some more people because definitely a lot of people want to talk this topic.
Okay, no problem, man.
All right. Well, Mario, before we get another caller, Abdomarez, I want to present this question to everybody. What does this mean? Rigondeaux beat the brakes off of Donair. Abdomar moves up and beat the brakes off of we're never going to get to that topic, I'm telling you. 925, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Where are you calling from and who are you?
Hey, I'm calling from Livermore, California, the upper side of the Bay Area.
Okay. Andre Ward, people's in the house.
Yeah. Not all that big on Andre Ward. I kind of agree with you that he ain't really had the right opposition to be right that high, but I want to bring up Jay Leon Love, you know, what people normally say about all Al Heyman's fighters, and with the decision aside of the night, I mean, why is none of the credit given to Jay Leon Love for taking on a good Road Warrior early on in his career?
He gets credit for it, but he lost the fight, man. It's kind of hard to give him credit when he lost the fight.
That's not his fault, but I'm saying, though, can you give him credit if he continues on with his career, whereas he's avoiding the things that Andre Berto did, you know, not taking on those strong opposition? I mean, Dave Rosado,
absolutely.
I mean, he's a big shot, but can't you call him a Road Warrior right now?
Look, I give him credit for telling Rosado he'd give him a rematch. Like, he should not give him a rematch. I mean, but, you know, at the end of the
bullshit.
You know what? At the end of the day, I don't know for sure.
Do you agree that he's taking the affirmative step to avoid what Al Heyman fighters have always been accused of?
Well, I mean, sure. I mean, at the same time, he fought a junior middleweight. Like, let's keep it real. But, no, I agree. I mean, that was a tough test. It was a huge step up. It was a huge step up for Love, you know. At the same time, like, you know, he's not building these crazy building blocks, but, you keep it in perspective. I give him all the credit in the world. I gave him credit for signing his name on the contract. You know what I'm saying? Like, I gave him credit for that. But, yeah, I thought he lost the fight last night, you know, so I'm not going to give him as much credit for beating Rosado as he would have if he would have, you know, really beat him. But he looked good in there against a battle-tested warrior. I mean, what can I say?
Okay, and, I just wanted to comment with Mayweather, whereas, you know, he's kind of in a predicament to whereas, you know, he's damned if he does, he's damned if he don't. I mean, he probably shouldn't even be at 147. I mean, what's wrong with him fighting Danny Garcia, the ring champion, at 140? What if Mayweather were to go down and make weight at 140, which he could still do, then people were just going to say, well, okay, now he's just fighting a smaller guy, but they're both ring champions. They're both lineal champions.
I like the way you think.
Well, let me tell you, what was your name again?
I think, why is that not a great fight between Mayweather and Danny Garcia? What if Mayweather were to go down and make 140, which he probably still can't do? Then everybody's just going to say, they just discredit him and say, well, okay, well, he just took on a smaller guy, but he's came up in weight. He already has not brought his power. If you look at his lower weight fights, he was knocking guys out left and right. He floored Corrales how many times? He had to move up in weight to get these bigger fights, and now he's stuck here. And now people are saying he needs to take on, before it was, well, he's ducking Sergio Martinez, and now he's ducking Canelo. Why is he ducking Canelo? Why is Canelo all of a sudden the big cash cow, like he has to fight him? And if he does fight Canelo, which, and he does win but takes some punishment, now he's probably stuck. He's got a 5-fight contract, and now people are going to want to see a double or a triple. They're going to want to see a 3-fight between him and a guy that can come into the fight weighing 172.
If you're not going to be real with us right now and admit that Canelo is the cash cow and deservedly so, then there's no hope for this call. Hold on. Let me get to your original point real quick. If he kills himself to make 140, because I completely disagree with you, I don't think he can anymore. He, you know, he couldn't make 144 against Marquez, or 145, whatever it's supposed to be. He can't make 140. If he kills himself to make 140 and fights Danny Garcia, I give him all the credit in the world. And a drained Mayweather, fighting Danny Garcia, I give him credit for that.
The drug testing issues in Texas. Can Canelo even come into the fight weighing 170 if he has to fight in Nevada State Commission?
I mean,
just look how much bigger Chavez Jr. was in all of his fights in Texas, but he was much smaller when he had to come in and fight the Martinez in Nevada.
Okay, but it doesn't matter. It's a good point, but it's an unnecessary point. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter how this fight gets done, as long as it gets done. That's the bottom line. Canelo can't make 147 anymore.
Does he have to fight him next, or can it build up?
No, it can build up. It's fine. That's what I'm saying. I'm not a Floyd Mayweather hater. I'm not saying that I only want to see him fight Canelo and that's it. I only want to see him work. But that's what I'm saying. Y'all are misunderstanding me. I have no problems with him laying the groundwork against other fighters. You know what I mean? I have no problem. But if he goes through this gauntlet of fighters and never takes on a guy where he comes in less than 80% to win. No, I'm sorry. I misspoke. Less than 90% to win. Then I'm sorry, that it's ridiculous. Don't come out and say you want to fight the best and give the fans what they want, when really all you want to do is keep your O and go. That's it. That's all he wants to do, is he wants to keep his own go. And I'm not hating on that. Canelo!
Yes, this is a question for you. Do you think that it would be a good event if Mayweather fights Garcia, then you got a good fight with Abner Morris under it, you know, and you make a complete card? You really make a great event. I thought last night was a great event.
What's your name again?
Oh, Casey from Oakland.
Casey, up until yesterday, I thought that Danny would lose to Mayweather, but he would have a shot at least at landing something big. I don't even know if that's possible anymore, man. He made Guerrero look like we were watching the fight in the Matrix, dude. Guerrero looked slower than molasses. He looked like the thickest pancake batter dripping out of the bowl into the pan. He was killing him with right hands, dude. How many right hands did he lead with?
I understand what you're saying, but I feel that Danny Garcia and Floyd Mayweather are walking around at a more closer mutual weight. And he is the lineal champion. I mean, he's the legit ring champion of 140. I think that they're a closer weight.
No, looking at it that way, it is the easier fight to make because of the comparison in weight. But I'm going to let you go. You could definitely call back. We want to free up the lines for some of these other callers, brother. But it is a more comparable weight. You're absolutely right.
All right, man.
I think that the 20 pounds Canelo's going to come in over the 154-pound limit. It's too much of a disadvantage, man. He's going to be 171, man. That's crazy.
Yeah, thanks for taking me, so I'll keep listening.
All right, brother. So, you could call in, but does anybody want to talk about Abner Mars and Ponce de Leon? Are you not impressed at what Abner Mars did? I mean, I know Abner Mars, well, rather, Ponce de Leon is no Nonito Donaire. But dropping Ponce twice? Did Gamboa drop him twice? Did Broner drop him twice? I mean, he essentially beat Ponce de Leon better than both of those men. 636, up. 626, you're live on the Box of Voice. Who's this?
All right. I want to talk about Abner Mars.
Go for it.
Mars is the pound for pound number three. That's all there is to be said. He's the motherfucking pound for pound number three. His resume can only be matched by Andre Ward. He went in there, he took Ponce de Leon out. Bernard and Top Rank have been ducking him like punks. And he went over, you know, he cleaned out Bantamweight. He beat Moreno. He beat Arbeco. He beat Dexion. You know, he got a draw against Perez, but, you know, Perez is gone now. And, you know, that's pretty much all there is to be said about Mars. He's a three-weight champion. And, you know, he's in the top of
town. He beat Perez in a rematch, didn't he?
Yeah, you know, that's right.
Hey, Mario, didn't Abner beat
Perez in a rematch?
Perez in a rematch?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's right. I forgot about that. But yeah, you know, he entered the tournament, which Danair and Montiel bet, and, you know, he cleaned it up. You know, the only person that's really on his level as far as, you know, that weight range is Rigondeaux, but, you know, Rigondeaux doesn't have the resume behind him to really be ranked in that sense, even though he has the skills.
No. You were on a roll till you fucked up right there. He just beat the number four pound for pound. That's all the resume you need. He beat the shit out of him.
Well, I mean, Mars beat the shit out of Moreno. And Moreno was just as proven, if not more so, than Danair was.
That's a tough one. I don't agree with
it. No, that's
find some people to be your co-defendant on it.
Those are Moreno fans. No, that's not true at all. No way.
Yeah, I'm not, man. Well, I'm saying that's fair. But I'm saying the thing is, I make Rigondeaux up there too. I'd say he's probably within the top five or six.
Yeah, I agree with you, but I don't agree with you. I mean, I don't think it's far off from that. I don't think it's far off from that. I don't think it's completely absurd, but, you know, that's just how I feel.
No, wait, Mario, I never said that Abner Mars belongs at number three. I'm telling you what he said because you were away.
Okay.
I'm saying that I don't agree with Moreno being a more credible opponent than Nonito Donaire, even though I think that Nonito Donaire had some hand-picked opponents. His hand-picked opponents were still probably better than Moreno's.
This
is Vincent, right?
I mean, the thing is, yeah, the resume behind it, but he's Moreno. With Moreno, the way I rank him is like how people rank Rigondeaux now. You know, he at least passed the eye test. He was going in there and he was dominating the opposition that he was facing. But the thing is, you know, Mars just, you know, he's running through guys that people keep saying, oh, he's going to lose, and he hasn't lost yet. They keep underrating the kid, and he hasn't lost yet. You know, the only person that's really fought competition as legitimately tough, as consistent as he has, is Andre Ward.
And, I mean, you could argue Mayweather, too, because Mayweather pretty much has just cleaned everything out, you know, at welterweight. You know, he's just such a level above that people want him to fight motherfucking heavyweights.
Well, you did an amazing job with this call. We're going to let you go to free up the lines, but you're Vincent, right?
Yes.
Well, we finally got you on, man. You got out of the matrix. You took the blue pill.
Yes.
Or the red pill, I don't know. All right, brother.
You take the blue pill.
All right, that's it.
The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole
goes. And that's where Mario is. He's all the way down the rabbit hole, trying to force Floyd to move up and wait. 636, you're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
Yo, this Andy again, bro. I was calling in from St. Louis again. I just wanted to know, how do you guys feel about Guillermo Rigondeaux, versus Abner Mattes?
It's a fight that we'd probably all love. We'd probably all pay for pay-per-view on it. But it would never happen until Rigondeaux's out of his contract or Mara's is.
Well, I'll say it like this. We're always in a position where we want to see the two best fighters fight, and it's like top-ranked Golden Boy prevents it from happening. We all get pissed off. In this case, I'm going to keep it real. Yes, Abner Mattes and Guillermo Rigondeaux is a fight that should happen based on where they're at in the division. But is it a fight that I'm clamoring to see? Not at all. I think stylistically it's not a very good matchup. I think there's a lot of problems it presents for both fighters. I don't think it's a good fight. I really don't. I don't think it's a great-looking fight. I think it's the ace king of the poker world, you know, the Anna Kournikova of tennis. I mean, it looks great on paper, but I don't think it really would. It's not that appealing to me. So I'm not that bummed out that it's a top-ranked Golden Boy beef thing, because I really don't want to see it, and not nearly as much as Donaire Mattes. That was the fight, guys, because while I think Donaire would have starched Mattes, I also believe it would have been in one hell of a fight. Now, in this scenario, I think Rigondeaux not only beats Mattes, but he does it in a way that's not very appealing towards fans. I don't think he makes any more fans fighting Mattes, and I don't think Mattes heightens his own legacy fighting Rigondeaux.
Yeah, he dropped off, but if anybody else wants to call in, 201-688-7127, you'll be calling in here live on the Boxing Voice, and we're talking Mayweather versus Guerrero, Ponce de Leon versus Abner Mattes, Leo Santa Cruz versus Munoz, J. Leon Love getting a controversial split decision victory over Gabriel Rosado, and we have our main man, Victor Salazar, in the building, the only guy on the panel to have an L. Oh,
I had an L for...
It's all right. It's all right.
Well, I had an L for picking Guerrero, but we'll just forget about it.
You pick Love, Mario?
Oh, you pick...
No.
Guerrero!
Oh, no. I picked Rosado, too. Yeah. No, I got two Guerreros. Right.
Don't hide now. Don't hide now.
No, I'm not hiding now. I'm straight.
Damn!
Straight.
Wait a minute. So, I wasn't even going to play the clip because I thought me and Mario split the win, but...
Look what you did, Vic.
You should have kept it then. You should have said you big Love.
I know,
you'd
right?
You'd be in a better place right now.
You're live on the Boxing Voice. Who's this?
Hey, yeah, I just had called in. I just want to see if y'all had seen Kareem Mayfield in his camp approach Danny Garcia's camp, and the fact that Angel Garcia didn't even open his mouth until security came and escorted the guy.
Nah, we didn't see that.
I'm not trying to pump your competitors or nothing, but it's not that big of a deal. I just want to know, it just seems kind of out of line once again that Zab Judah kind of proved it. I think it was all your guys, the Boxing Voice, that Zab Judah was saying Angel's not going to say anything until security arrives, and Kareem Mayfield was just trying to come up to him and see, if they can make a fight. And then Angel got just flipped. I mean, he loses it once security comes and escorts Kareem Mayfield's friends. And then people were even trying to keep Kareem saying he didn't do anything, and they still escorted them.
I seen the video. I know what he's talking about. But my question to you is, what has Kareem Mayfield done to get a fight with Danny Garcia?
Oh, I'm not trying to say that Kareem Mayfield needs to fight Danny Garcia. I'm just supportive of Danny Garcia. I just feel that Angel Garcia like kind of really getting out of line with the fake tough guy. I mean, is that really still needed? I mean, is that working for Danny or is that working against him now in his career?
I'll take this one, guys. I think that it is working for him simply because the fans don't hate Danny. The hate gets directed at the father. Then Danny goes in and puts on a good performance, and he continues to look like the good guy. Plus, factor in the entertainment value. I love it.
Oh, and what about, why can't Canelo move up and fight Kid Chocolate in the Bronx?
Why would he do that? Why in the world would he do that?
Because he goes in there and takes over another market. They get a sellout crowd in the Bronx, and Canelo pops into another market, perhaps the Latin market.
Well, he doesn't need...
Spanish, maybe he doesn't have the Latin market, you know what I mean? He could go in there and be live, you know, he could go on the press tour, shake hands with a lot more of the Puerto Ricans, the Dominicans, a lot of the other type of Latin...
Okay. I see your point, and it's a fair assertion. But let me tell you this: for the risk of fighting Kid Chocolate, because Kid Chocolate is looking more and more like a beast every single outing, for the risk that it is and the reward that he gets, it is not worth it, my friend. To move up to 160 and fight Kid Chocolate, who is arguably one of the top three middleweights right now in the division, it's just not worth it, man. I don't think it is. I don't think. He doesn't need it.
That's a double standard. That's a catch-22.
He doesn't. No, it's not. He doesn't need.
Make his name big. Canelo already had his name big. You know, just.
But what is? How does Kid? Where does Kid Chocolate deserve? Where does Kid Chocolate get off? What? Why does he deserve that? Kid Chocolate's campaigning his own way. He doesn't want to fight Canelo. He wants to fight Martinez. He wants to fight.
Like what they say with Amir Khan. Amir Khan has not really shown himself to be a top level fighter, but he has a huge amount of fans. If Canelo fights,
he's not going
to sell out in the Bronx.
It's not the same thing at all, man. Because Floyd and hold on. Floyd and Canelo are the top two draws in the sport.
Why does Canelo not even go to the top 50? Mayweather went to make his name big. Why can't Canelo move up to 160 or even fight at a catchweight? Hold on.
Before Mayweather fought Guerrero, and before there was ever rumblings about Mayweather fighting Canelo, what was the one question everyone asked? Canelo needs to be a credible opponent. Oh, that's Trout. Trout's that credible opponent. And guess what, guys?
That's one fight. How many credible fights has Mayweather had?
Credible fights has Guerrero had? Berto? Aiden?
Guerrero is look at his body of work. Look at his career. Let's talk about
At featherweight? At lightweight?
At featherweight. Let's look at his fight at 126 and 130.
You wanna pump him? You wanna pump him as a 126 fighter? Well, what are we going to throw in Gamboa against Floyd Mayweather next? Like, where's it in? Should Chris John get a fight? I mean, it's ridiculous. That his body of work outside of the 147 division does not count. Does not count at all.
You're arguing a guy's record that he doesn't have good enough, but you're only saying Canelo has done enough because of one fight.
Because it was against the best fighter in the division.
It was against the guy everyone wanted to see him against. And now that he beats him, it's only one fight. You guys were calling for this fight how long?
Because you thought he'd lose.
Because you thought Trout would destroy Canelo. You were calling for it, and now that Canelo has done that task, it's not worth it now. Come on, guys.
So Canelo's supposed to sit on his high horse and not take on these big events. All I'm saying is that if he fights Kid Chocolate, which could be easily made, he gets a ton of money. He can tap into a new market. He can tap into the Latin market, but he just simply doesn't have to do it because you're gonna say Mayweather is ducking him.
Kid Chocolate brings nothing to the table, my friend.
Canelo didn't have to pull out of the undercard.
Caller, what's your name?
Hey, this was Casey, man. The line was open. I just wanted to come up with some new topics.
Casey, check it out. my co-hosts are making good points, but really the nail in the coffin is this. Not only has Peter Quillen, he doesn't bring anything to the table besides a belt. The Barclays Center that you're offering up as Canelo to make all this money, it only houses 14,000 people. Canelo just sold 40,000 tickets. Going to New York City and selling 14 is nothing.
I'm just saying that it opens a new market, the Latin market. That's all I'm saying.
What do you mean? But hold on. But I think Canelo's got the Latin market down packed, though.
Yeah, I agree.
No, I mean,
he
like,
sold 40,000 Latin market, tickets.
But I don't know that he has the Puerto Ricans and Dominicans. I think that's why Canelo wants to fight Cotto.
Okay, I see where he's coming from. He wants to tap that East Coast market.
Move up and wait, fight him. Yeah, I'm just trying to bring up a new topic. I'm not trying to be too argumentative with everybody.
No, this is a great call. My man, this is the voice of the people. I mean, you could say fuck you, Vic, all day long. I don't care.
Yeah,
this is the voice of the people.
You made great points. Look, at the end of the day, you made a great point. I'm not just. You know, I'm not trying to argue with you at all about that. It would be great for Canelo to find a way to tap into that market faster. At the same time, Chavez had Puerto Rican fans. He had Dominican fans. It took a while, but he eventually got over on mostly everybody. And that's what happens with the Hispanic market, the Mexican-American market. Eventually, it kind of floods the rest of the market, in a sense. And everyone starts to pay attention because it's the person to pay attention to. You know, there are plenty of Dominicans and Puerto Ricans.
Would that make for a bigger event with Cotto, though? I mean, Cotto,
absolutely.
Cotto gets himself another belt. Canelo gets him a fight in the Bronx to tap into the to expose himself to the Latin market. I'm not just saying the fight itself, but I'm talking about the press tour. You know, going out there taking pictures, shaking hands, all these type of things. Then you got the Cotto, and then that's a huge.
I don't even need that much. I don't even. Yeah.
And you got the fight.
I don't even need a belt.
For the fight. If people don't want to tune in for Mayweather, for Devin Alexander, and all these type of things, well, then Mayweather's going to be the one to suffer, but there's still roads to build the fight.
I agree with you. I 100% agree with you. And look, I don't even need a belt. They can fight next. Shit, I don't care. I want to see that fight. Honestly, I want to see Cotto Canelo. I really do. I don't care that he lost a Trout. I don't care that he doesn't have a belt. I don't care that he doesn't have a win since, 2011 or whatever. I don't care. I don't care about any of that stuff. I still want to see the fight because you're right. It's a tremendous appeal. Puerto Rican, Mexico, it's just it would be amazing. It would be really amazing. It would be a spectacle, and I would love to see it. Absolutely. I don't need any other guys for them to fight. They can fight next, and I'll watch it. I'll buy it up for $70 like last night.
And what about what are you guys' thoughts on Kareem Mayfield? I know, Ness, you said, you know, what has he done to earn that fight? I'm not trying to put him on that pedestal, but, I mean, why is he not even in the picture? How does Mike Dallas get into the picture to fight Lucas Matisse? I know that was a quick fight made, but why isn't Kareem even talking any of these fights in the 140-type tournament?
I think he should be in the mix.
I just want to clear something up. Hold on, Vic.
Go ahead.
I just want to clear something up. That was Vic that said that.
Yeah, Vic said that.
But
I agree with him.
I totally agree with Vic. And you got to remember that Kareem Mayfield, I think, is signed to Thompson or Gary Shaw, and that's why he's not in the picture.
But he's with a small fire promoter. Dallas Jr. is on the same camp. And Dallas Jr. is an easy walkover. They knew that. Why can't Kareem Mayfield? Because, Peterson fights Kendall Holt. Is Kendall Holt a stronger competitor at this time than Kareem Mayfield?
You're
bringing him to the Bay Area. Back to the Bay Area, this is one of the largest metropolitan, one of the most successful areas in the United States.
Hey guys, I forgot that KC was from the fucking Bay Area. That's what's going on.
No. I see where he's coming from, though. I see where he's coming from.
Struggling with Mauricio Herrera.
Why is Dallas Jr.?
No.
Dallas Jr. get in there with Kareem Mayfield can't get.
I'll tell you why. Hold on. Go ahead.
The man struggled with Mauricio Herrera.
Hey, but Mauricio Herrera took Mike Alvarado out of the war.
All right, but he struggled with Mauricio Herrera.
And he beat Provodnikov.
Yeah, he does. He searches for those balls, but I just think he could get into the conversation and with the the market that he brings in, but
I agree with him. I agree with him, but here's my question. Here's my question to you. Hey, KC, when's the last time Mayfield was on TV, though?
Yeah.
That's what matters.
And I understand, Casey, I understand your argument with Mike Dallas Jr. and the rest of that crop, but you got to understand all that was circumstantial. Lamont Peterson's coming back off of what? It was like a year layoff and all that steroid shit. At the end of the day, they were looking for that kind of fight. You know what I'm saying? They didn't want Kareem Mayfield because that was too high up the ranks. They wanted somebody that they could get in there with that would be a soft touch into the water, which Kendall Holt presented some danger. It was a good enough fight to sell, but it wasn't a dangerous enough fight to lose. That was why it made it so perfect. Mike Dallas was on short notice, and he was the best available opponent, and it was a great opponent for them to pick. Kareem Mayfield at this point, I hate to break it to you, but he's too much risk for the reward. You get what I'm saying? At the end of the day, I like Kareem Mayfield. I'm a fan of his. I've always liked watching him. He's got some really good highlight reel knockouts on ESPN. You know, he's a great fighter. I really like him, and I think he should be in the mix eventually. But right now, he's just too much risk for the reward. He's not there yet. His name is there, and 140 stacked.
We're going to let you go, KC. We got to get some more callers on here. But you could definitely call back like you did. And that number is 201-688-7127, or Skype us at The Boxing Voice. We're going to touch a little bit more on Abner Mares beating the brakes off of Ponce de Leon, basically shocking everybody, being able to come up with more power than he showed at 122. I mean, who was expecting that? I picked him to win, but Jesus.
I'm not going to lie, man. Abner Mares. Fucking G, that guy, man. I always pick against him. He always proves me wrong. And you know what? Next time Abner Mares fights, I'm going to pick him. He's probably going to lose because I'm picking him.
Don't pick him, please.
But I mean, I didn't think his power was going to carry. No, he put Ponce on his ass.
No, Vic, you know, honestly.
I can't believe it. I couldn't believe it. He was impressive. Impressive.
I picked Mares.
If someone stole the show, it was Abner Mares.
Yeah, absolutely. I picked Mares, and he's still surprised me. I mean, the way he was carrying that power, the way he was carrying his build, I mean, that was the other thing, is that fight got rough at times, and not only did he hold his own, but, you know, he backed up Ponce a lot. And there were some moments in the mid-rounds where PDL did have his moments, you know what I mean? I think it was like after the fourth round when it was like his scariest moment, he started backing up Abner Mares a bit, you know what I mean? But it wasn't enough, it wasn't much at all, and it was an Abner Mares night for sure. And I agree with you, I think he was the biggest story of the night.
I think so, because I'm not saying it was easy, but it looked like Mares was comfortable.
Yeah.
Comfortable at 126, like this guy, this is your division, and I'm coming up. And I'm beating you at it.
Win a title, man.
Yep.
Shit's legit.
Two questions for you guys. From the chat, they're saying that Mares is working with Victor Conti. And second question is, Vic, you're hammered.
Am I? What did I do wrong?
Is that a question?
Is that a question or response?
No. I kind of hear you slurring, but it's cool. You know, I drink on the show all the time. This ain't PG, even though they call in. 315, you're live on the box. What's this?
Hey, man.
I just wanted to call earlier. I just wanted to throw one, like, matchup up there, and I was going to get off. I just wanted to see Mares versus Gary Russell Jr. I think that's a good one.
Mares and Gary Russell.
That's a makeable fight.
That's not a bad
fight at all. We can dog with Chow Ring, so why not Gary Russell Jr.?
But what's
your good fight?
Anybody?
This is me on Mighty from Syracuse.
Hey Mighty, I think you're rushing Gary Russell or Gary Russell.
I heard interview with him like a while back, man, and he was saying he wanted the winner of Mares Ponce de Leon. He was sounding pretty confident that he'd win.
He wanted Ponce for a while.
Yeah, and Ponce his last seven fights been TBAs, if you didn't know.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I agree. They bombs, but he been watching them up, so why not throw him in there if he wanted?
Yeah, but anybody, listen, anybody could look good versus bums, man. Let's see him versus somebody good, then start putting him in there with Mares.
Hey, I feel what you're saying, but hey, if he wanted, man, just let Mares watch him up. I'm a huge Mares fan.
So, hey, if he won it, you know, that's the easiest fight that can happen. So, why not? Just
well, one thing you're forgetting is this. One thing you're forgetting is this. Marez keeps winning versus guys he's supposed to lose to. And Gary Russell signed a Hal Heyman. They're not going to do that fight. Not anytime
soon.
I agree.
But Marez, man, that dude's incredible, man. I was looking at the fight last night, man, and just to see his body size and look at Ponce de Leon, and I just can't believe how he just demolished that dude, man. Like, Marez, geez, man. Like, dang, man, that dude's official. And you think about, like, Ponce de Leon gave Broner trouble back in the past, and you look at what Marez did.
And Gamboa.
Like, yeah, exactly. So, man, Marez, he definitely top 5 pounds per pound. You know what I mean?
Look, I'm the main one that wanted to talk Abner Marez versus Ponce. But since we got you, what's your thoughts on the Jay Leon-Rosado fight? How do you see that fight? Who you had winning?
Honestly, hey, that's a good. Thank you for asking me that, man. But to be honest with you, like I said on my Twitter, man, that was a toss-up fight, man. You know what I mean? Like, I felt like if you really look at that fight, man, Jay Leon Love, man, was winning. Like, he won a lot of the rounds just outboxing him. When you think about it, go look at the fight. Like, most of them rounds, Jay Leon Love was winning. Then, like, the last 15 to 10 seconds, for some reason, he would just take his foot off the pedal, and Rosado would just start catching him. But I feel like, honestly, man, I feel like it was a toss-up fight. I guess you can look at it and you can say, oh, Jay Leon won by a round or two, or you can say Rosado won by a round or two. I think it was a toss-up fight, man.
You know what it is? I've been explaining it like this. I've seen the fight 3 times already, okay? And right. The only change in my initial scorecard is I actually gave one more round to Rosado. I had it 95-94 originally. It was 96-93, I guess it was. This is what I think it was. And remember the
Rancis? I had the same card.
Remember the Rancis? Remember the Rancis Bartholomew card back in January on Friday Night Fights? And everybody called that a robbery. Now, right. Beav, I remember explaining it a certain way. There are certain fights that take place, and even if they're only 1 round, 2 rounds apiece, that usually means it could have gone either way. If it's close enough to be a 1 round fight, it's usually close enough to go the other way or be a draw or something like that. And that's what I initially thought. But after seeing the fight 2 more times.
It could have been a draw.
Yeah, I think this is one of those fights where
what you guys need to know is this. Herb Santos, the dude with the ridiculous scorecard.
What a fucking right. Herb.
Idiot.
He's reportedly got married in 1962. Right. I highly doubt people were getting married at 17 and 20 at that time. So this dude is easily 70 years old.
Yeah, they need
to
get a part of that
title
game,
fight.
I ain't gonna lie, that
was pretty.
Well,
this dude is so old, Mario.
That was out of there, man. For that.
This dude is so old that he literally scored.
That was like before the fight. You know what I mean? Jay Leon Love was 15-0, man, and Rosado was struggling in that fight. That was a close fight.
Yeah.
Rosado got experience, man. Like, he should have went in there and really demolished those dudes. For him to struggle and make it a close fight like that. And all the experience and fighters he went against, you got to look at it like that too, man. Like,
yeah, definitely.
I don't give Rosado much credit.
Very close fight.
What?
I mean, not Rosado.
I don't give up credit because he's fighting a guy that's moving up in weight again. This isn't Gabe's weight class. He's not 160.
No way.
And for love to come 161.5.
He got dropped once. He almost got dropped twice.
He got dropped once by a guy at 154. And you want a title shot?
Gary
Quillen, Gennady Golovkin. Oh my God! This Jay Leon Love is in for a big battle if he wants to fight those two guys.
He got his head rolling off his shoulders.
And once he got dropped, everybody got brainwashed. Like, oh, he got dropped, man. You know what I mean?
No, it's not about that.
I had Gabe winning 6-4 plus the knockdown.
Look, at the end of the day,
I have it 96-93, I think, same as you.
If you give all the swing rounds to Love, I still think that fight's maybe a draw. That's what I think. Gabe won more definite rounds, I think, than Love did. That fight had to be perfectly scored for Love. Like, all those little variables where it's like, oh, Gabe could have won, but Love could have won. No, they all gave it to Love. Like, that's what I'm saying is that fight wasn't – it didn't play out the way people think it was. It wasn't necessarily like a one-round fight. Gabe won more definite rounds than Love. That's the bottom line. Could it have been a draw? Sure. But that's only if you're giving Love every benefit of the doubt, and that's wrong. It's plain and simple wrong.
You're right.
And not to mention,
throw it out there. The Santa Cruz dude, he's pretty good. He takes a lot of hits, man. And if he go get somebody with a lot of power, man, he's probably gonna catch that fade and get knocked out, man. He was taking a lot of hits. The dude just wasn't strong enough to hurt the dude, man.
You know, honestly, though, I think he's one of the bigger punches.
I'm going to free up the lines, man, but thanks for the call. You could definitely call back.
I think he's going to end up being one of the biggest punchers of that division.
I just want to say that judge also judged Marvin Hagler versus Tommy Hearns, dude.
Oh, I thought you were going to say he's so old he judged David and Goliath. I thought it was going to be like one of those Yo Mama jokes.
No, he really judged that fight, though.
Oh, okay.
So, moving on, until we get some callers... Pauly Malignaggi, Adrian Broner, press conference happened. I want to ask Mario and Vic, have you seen the videos?
No.
Yes, sir.
Who do you think won the war of words?
I think it was Pauly. I think he was funny.
I think Broner was
more animated.
I think from what I heard off Twitter, I think Pauly won, and I think Pauly won off the shirt that he had. I mean, Pauly had the mini-me, Floyd Mayweather, Dr. Evil, mini-me, Adrian Broner. All Broner had was, hey, Paulette. I think Pauly won that war.
But I know I'm going to sound like I'm defending Broner, but I think we got to give him big points on calling Pauly's girlfriend live. And having her actually answer and be on speakerphone over the mic to hundreds of reporters and basically siding with Broner and Broner and Pauly admitting that Broner's fucking sleeping with his girl. That's tough, man.
It's rough. It is. That was such an awkward thing.
That's Pauly's ex, right? So who cares? That's like Jay-Z calling out Nas's baby mom, but Nas's rhyme was way better.
People catch feelings. 50
Cent just tweeted. Look at what 50 Cent just tweeted. Wait.
I can't see that shit. There you go.
I'm going to fix it. Love be like, I still won that fight.
Nice.
Yo, he's a Mayweather hater, dude.
Why shouldn't he be, though?
I know.
I would be, too.
That was funny. So Vernon Parris is getting back in the mix.
Good for him.
Versus Manuel Perez.
I like that fight. No, that Manuel Perez, that's the one that fought on Friday Night Fights, and he fought last on, what was it? I think it was Univision. Yeah, he's not bad. He scraps.
I got to check him out. I don't remember him. Who'd he fight on Friday Night Fights?
A prospect.
I don't remember that dude. Vic, you remember Manuel Perez?
No.
When y'all see his record, you're going
to
remember
him. Sounds like somebody I went to grade school with.
Sounds like my cousin.
So, this Joel Diaz, is this junior that's fighting Cornelius Locke? This my 11-0 fighter of the year?
Wait, who?
Prospect of the year? Joel Diaz versus Cornelius Locke, 10-round featherweight.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it is.
Wow. The boy just continues to step up. 11 fights, man. I mean, 11 fights, he's already fighting Cornelius Locke.
No, that's definitely awesome. 9-5-1,
your boxing voice. Who's this?
Hey, this is Bobby from Riverside.
Bobby, what's going on, brother?
So,
yeah,
we're doing great, man. We're doing great.
Okay, I just wanted to call in. I don't know what you guys are talking about right now, though.
Whatever you want to talk about, man.
No, you could talk about what you want to talk about.
Okay, I just wanted to bring up just real quick about Floyd Mayweather. See, the thing about him is, it's not that I don't think it's that people want to see him lose.
It's just that the things that he's done in his career that takes away from his legacy. The first one is when he came back out of retirement and he said he was going to fight, he wanted to fight Marquez. At that time, Marquez had never fought above 135 pounds. So he agreed to a catch weight of 144. Mayweather didn't make the weight, so he paid the fine. Now,
$600,000 fine.
Advantage, like Mario was saying, talking about advantages. That's Floyd's advantage. So, right there, I can't really give Floyd credit for that win. Because Marquez is a little guy. Second, when he had the opportunity to fight Pacquiao, he didn't fight him. For whatever reason. That was the best fight at that time, and he didn't fight him. And to me, it's because it was too risky for him. See, that takes away from so that's why it bothers me.
But Pacquiao didn't fight Floyd Mayweather either.
They were both to blame.
I think, man, Pacquiao, but look at Pacquiao's resume, though. Look at his pedigree. Who has he avoided? Who has he avoided?
But
he
Mayweather fought two. Listen. Mayweather fought two up-and-coming prospects or contenders in the welterweight division, young guys in their prime, Ortiz and Guerrero. Pacquiao fought Cotto. Pacquiao fought Margarito. Pacquiao fought Joshua Clady. Give him credit, but don't give him too much.
Well, look, in all fairness...
You can't give Mayweather too much credit either.
Exactly.
Listen, here's my thing. Mayweather, in my eyes, is a top 25 fighter of all time. Top 25. And you know what? He could have been a top 5 guy if he would have fought Cotto or Margarito in 2007. Exactly. If he would have fought Pacquiao in 2009. But he didn't. Exactly. After 135...
The top-ranked fighters.
No, but look, you can give Floyd credit for fighting the Ortizes and the Guerreros and shit on Pacquiao for not fighting the Bradleys and the Alexanders or whoever was available at that time in the 140 division that could have moved up and fought those catchweights. But you got to give credit for Pacquiao because Margarito's still going to go down as the guy that Mayweather didn't fight.
And we'll never mention his name. Who was that guy?
Exactly. Even if most people feel like it would have been easy work, it doesn't matter. He still didn't fight him. Hey, when has easy work for Floyd ever been a reason to not fight a guy? You know what I'm saying? And Cotto, at a time, he fought Cotto before Floyd Mayweather did. Of course Floyd had to fight him at 154. Of course, because what was going to be the excuse if he made him come back down to his weight class? Not only is he fighting an older Cotto than Pacquiao did, but he's making him do the same shit. He had to. Pacquiao forced his hand. If Pacquiao would never have fought him, he would have fucking made him come down to 147 for sure. There's no doubt in my mind. Not taking anything away from either fighter, but they both fought reasonable opponents at the time.
I'm not taking anything away from Floyd, but I'm just saying this. You can't claim to be the greatest of all time. And when you retire from the sport the first time, the two guys that were claiming this guy, they were this close from your throne were Margarito and Cotto. You didn't fight him. Hold on. 2009. When's the last time two guys were in their prime at the same weight division and could have just... I mean, come on. Sorry.
Nick, I got somebody on the line.
Tell him. Debate me.
Who would rather die than not defend his champion, Floyd Mayweather? Go for it.
Man, it ain't like that.
Here we go.
Man, look, man. Y'all need to cut the bullshit, man. Floyd signed the contract. Pac didn't sign, man. It's on the record, man. Look it up. Y'all discrediting the game, man, not telling it how it is, man. I mean, for real.
First time it was on Floyd.
What's up?
The first time the fight didn't happen was on Floyd.
No, he signed.
No, he said. He said, he didn't.
Nobody signed, homie.
Oh, ATL, I love you. You're
breaking my heart.
Nobody signed.
He sent his contract back saying, I want a 14-day cutoff.
No, that did not happen. Come he on. Did not sign anything. Maybe he sent back some renegotiations, but he didn't sign.
No, he did. Nah, look it up, man. I'm not gonna make up nothing to defend Floyd. I don't really care like that.
I don't either. At the end of the day, USADA, whatever. Who cares? USADA's proven to be the worst drug testing company in the world. Am I right or wrong? Let's talk about USADA. Yeah. I mean, we want to talk about drug testing. Who cares? Exactly. Who cares? USADA sucks.
What do you mean, who cares about a drug test, man? You claim to be a boxing fan, and you don't care who's clean and who's
dirty?
Hey,
you guys watch Morales, Danny Garcia, right?
That's on them. They knew, though.
No, that's Golden Boy and USADA. Being like this. And not to mention, USADA threw away drug tests from Quillen and freaking Winky Wright. But no one talks about that. But USADA is the way to go.
Vic, you can't defend a cheat by saying, oh, everybody's doing it, so oh well, man.
I'm not defending anyone. I'm just saying, if you put the onus on USADA and you think that Floyd's credible by going with USADA, then you got the game fucked up too.
But ATL, you can't go around accusing people of stuff that you have nothing, and you can't say same stuff, man. It's the same shit.
You believe the fight was going to happen this on Floyd. They sued him. How come they didn't sue Pauly, man? Pauly put it out there on blast, man, loud and clear, dude. I mean, if it's about calling the dude out on steroids, I mean, Pauly is, he's on steroids, man, point blank. 2009, put it out there. Why not sue him? I mean, it's bullshit, man. Y'all defended bullshit, man. I got to be honest. And Cotto was with Bob. Why would Bob ruin Cotto with Floyd? If he couldn't touch him at 36 with 20-pound advantage, how's he going to touch him when Floyd is in his prime?
Floyd did plenty of interviews where he said Floyd did, it wasn't, it, you can't put it on Cotto, and maybe it was, but we don't know. But Floyd did plenty of interviews where he said he wasn't going to fight Cotto. Plenty of them. You can look those up.
As soon as he got out of Top Rank, man, what is wrong with y'all, man? What are y'all talking about?
No. He fought as soon as he was a financially viable opponent. That was the biggest issue of them all. You can see, you're blaming Pacquiao for everything on the Floyd fight, and then you're saying you're not a Floyd fan. But I'm saying it was both of their fault.
I'm blaming Bob Arum. Bob was never making that fight. And if you believe he was, man, y'all don't know the game.
So you saying Mayweather doesn't have a boss?
Never.
Mayweather doesn't have a boss. Mayweather's boss is Al fucking Heyman.
Now he's the boss of bosses.
Boss of bosses is Al fucking Heyman. Well, you guys want to say that Pacquiao has a boss? Well, listen to me. Listen to me, guys. Listen to me. Come on, guys.
His boss get him paid, dude.
And Pacquiao doesn't get paid?
Stop making a financial thing, fellas.
Pacquiao boss got him knocked out by a fighter that they knew Pacquiao couldn't beat, man.
What?
Idiot. Dumb shit, man.
So that means we should praise Mayweather's handlers for putting him easier in there with easier comp. All right, I got it, guys. Competitive fights don't matter if the Floyd Mayweather fights. Doesn't matter.
Easier. Floyd beat the dude 121-08, man. What are you talking about?
Because he made him come up 2 weight classes. Did you forget that?
Marquez called
2 weight classes, man. ATL. 2, pace, not 1, not 140, 147, ATL. Come on, man.
Let me ask you this. You want to see a rematch? Keep it real. You want to see a rematch?
Let's see a rematch then. Let's see it. Let's see it on Memo Heredia, who you guys are claiming is a fucking steroid dealer. Let's do it.
If Floyd needs to fight Canelo or Martinez, man, y'all got the game twisted.
Vic, you want
to
see a Marquez rematch?
Then who do you want to see Floyd against? Who do you want to see Floyd against? Because apparently, after yesterday, Canelo's too big. But De La Hoya and Cotto wasn't too big.
Hey, man. Hey. Vic,
listen, guys. Mayweather has soft hands.
What weight did De La Hoya and Cotto start at? You claiming no box. What weight did they start at?
doesn't matter right now. It doesn't matter.
It does matter.
Why does it matter now when the biggest fight to be made is Canelo Mayweather?
Maybe Canelo will be a middleweight one day, but he's not a middleweight right now.
Oh, my God, man. Y'all don't understand. Sure. Guys, man.
You
y'all don't understand.
Everyone else doesn't understand.
If you want to fight him, fight him. But why you not calling?
What's the argument?
I'm trying to see why not. He knocked out the monster. Call for it. Since Floyd's victory against him doesn't count because it was tainted because of 2 pounds, but you want Floyd to fight a guy 25 pounds bigger. But you're crying about 2 pounds.
But see, that's what I'm saying. You're talking about either.
I'm not crying about either. I don't give a fuck.
Okay.
ATL, I don't give a fuck about Marquez Mayweather, but why? Why is Canelo all of a sudden not value?
Call out the word.
But listen. Before April 20th, Canelo was easy work. But now that Canelo beat Trout,
I never said that, Vic. I said
not you. ATL.
Not big enough at 54, man.
I know you from the time you said this. I respect that argument. But for everyone else to say that is bullshit because fucking a month ago, Canelo was easy work.
I just don't get what too big means. What does too big mean? Like you keep saying he's too big. Like, what is he fucking Andre Wood? Like, he's too big to give the advantage?
Mario, ATL, from the start,
yeah.
I respect him because he said, you know, Floyd shouldn't be at 154 because Cotto outweighed him for 20 pounds. There's no reason for him to be fighting Martinez. He said it from the beginning, and I respect that. It's just the other people that are jumping on saying that Canelo's not worthy because he's this, and that. When a month ago, Canelo was easy work.
I got to say one thing.
You got to get to some of these calls, man.
I think Canelo needs to stay at 54 and clean out his division, man, and be a boss. If he got it like that, stay fight guys in your division and clean it out because there's plenty of hungry guys in there, man.
I don't mind that either.
ATL, give us a call back. Let me get to some of these calls, brother.
All right, let's go.
But as always, great call, man.
Nah, I respect. Like I said, ATL kept it real from the beginning.
Robert Ortiz, go for it.
Yeah, no, I was just wondering what you guys think since we're talking about legacies. You guys are talking about him fighting Canelo, but I'm just wondering what. I mean, the way Floyd looked last night, dude, he can do this for a really long time. I mean. Robert Guerrero's definitely not the best fighter in the world. Mayweather is, but I mean, he made him look like a fucking amateur. Sucks. He just sucked ass, basically. And so I'm just thinking.
No. Once you say what you text me.
Well, I'm sorry.
I said, once you say what you text me.
All right, you're right. No, I said because I got excited off the Berto win. You're right. I'll eat some crow on that. I got excited off the Berto win. I was like, well, he presents some problems. He's got good chin. He has no holes. And later when I watched, I sent you my official prediction saying that I thought Mayweather would beat him. Or at least I sent it to somebody. I don't remember who. But, yeah.
And then what did you text me last night?
I said, I don't know. Mayweather's gnarly. I don't know.
I just wanted you to say the gnarly.
He's gnarly.
Hey, Trap on YouTube.
What?
I see you calling in, brother. As soon as we get done with Robert Ortiz, we're going to get on with you.
Yeah. Well, my question, I guess, to you guys is like, what should he do, really? I mean, he can chase a huge challenge and go up and fight Canelo. Or what if he just stays at welterweight and just tries to hold the longest title reign like Bernard Hopkins or Marvin Hagler? I mean, does he need to move up in weight to keep his legacy going? I mean, realistically, he keeps.
I don't think he does, Rob.
I don't think he does either.
Well, I don't.
You know why I don't think he does.
I don't think it's fair, man. I don't even think it's fair that people are forcing him to move up because they can't find anyone
to beat. Look, it's not a force.
Look good versus him.
No. Look. It's not about forcing, Rob. Look, this is what it's about. At the end of the day. You're going to parade yourself around with this five-fight guarantee, and you're going to say that you're going to do these things in such a manner of time. Okay, and that's fine. But at the end of the day, guys, we only got De La Hoya as our basis of what Floyd Mayweather's power was capable of. That's my only thing, is I don't want one of the greatest fighters in the history of the sport, one of the most money-making fighters in the history of the sport, to exit the sport before we see one final hurrah. You know what I mean? And that's Canelo. Like, that's what I'm saying. No, his legacy isn't tainted by not fighting Canelo. However, I agree with Karen Mulvaney that his legacy is somewhat tainted by not fighting Pacquiao. But that being said, no, he cannot fight Canelo, and no one's going to really remember it because Canelo's not going to go down as one of the biggest threats in boxing. But we need to see that, I think, before he goes. And Devin Alexander doesn't provide that. We'll see what the pay-per-view numbers do when they come back, but I guarantee they don't get better from here. They don't. Depending on who he fights, they're not going to get better. If people are seen as not a, as a viable opponent as Robert Guerrero, fight fans aren't stupid, even the casual ones. They know, you know, what the legit looks like. And I think we need that one huge mega promotion that can eclipse all other promotions. And Pacquiao's gone. It has to be Canelo. And it has to happen before he leaves, guys. It has to. It has to happen. It, for the betterment of the sport.
Mario, why are you taking this show to rush it? He's got five more fights.
But that's what I'm saying. No. But look, Ness, that's my point. He doesn't have to fight next. But you know Floyd Mayweather is a very calculating man. Okay? He is premeditating. And if he is not going to fight Canelo now, he'll never fight him. And I don't mean like he won't fight him now, he won't never fight him. I mean he's made up his mind whether he's going to fight him now. Like right now. He knows if he's going to fight him or not. Whether it's next fight, two fights, three fights, or never, he knows. It is true. I guarantee you.
What if Canelo doesn't guarantee look great
versus Cotto? Then I'll probably try to jump in there and fight him. Are you kidding? Yeah, that'll be the best thing for Canelo. Exactly, yeah.
For you to say he made up his mind now is wrong.
No. He's made up his mind whether he's going to fight Canelo. And I'm not saying he's done it one way or the other. Like, don't get me wrong. That's what I'm saying. Y'all think that y'all keep putting all this on me like I'm some Floyd hater. I'm saying this stuff. I'm not. I'm just trying to keep it real. I'm just trying to keep it real on the show. At the end of the day, we know Floyd Mayweather has a history of not fighting certain fights. You know what I'm saying? And the tougher the fight is, those are usually the fights. And Canelo's a tough fight.
I have to actually agree with you, Mario. I feel like you've already leaned towards not taking that fight. I already feel
exactly.
Like
thank you.
Already,
well,
already,
Rob, did you hear? Did you hear when Kieran came on, and he basically said that the rumors are there that he doesn't want to fight Canelo.
He already started.
He didn't say that.
Laid out his excuses, and he already kind
of. No, Kieran didn't say that.
A little.
Kieran said that.
Laying down the groundwork for basically not fighting Canelo.
The rumors are there. So what's the difference? The rumors are there that he said he doesn't want to fight Canelo, and that's why I asked Kieran. I asked Kieran that day, and I was like, "Listen, so you're telling me Mayweather is gonna walk away from the two biggest money fights in the sport?" I said it. Come on, guys.
I could see. Hey, Rob.
Let Rob finish up because you guys don't even know the amount of calls we're getting right now. I guess whatever we're talking about made people upset.
I agree kind of with Mario that I think the pay-per-view numbers go down from here. There's no other challenge outside of that. I mean, there's no other welterweight that looks legit. So, I mean, he's going to have to take on a big challenge or just, you know, keep on making, you know, still a shit ton of money, but not what he's used to. And I'm thinking maybe a few fights down the line, he may take it. He may want to end his career. But the thing is, that O is so important to everything he does that he can't risk it before his contract's up. So maybe at the end, maybe five fights down the line, maybe he does fight Canelo. But as of right now, I don't think he's in a rush to. I don't really want to rush him because Canelo can still do a lot of stuff. He could still prove himself a little more. But how do I want to see the fight? Hell yeah, but I don't know, man. If Floyd just keeps on defending, if he looks the way he did last night, he could be a welterweight champion and go down as the best ever at welterweight if he just keeps on just beating everybody and just keeps the stranglehold on the division.
Quiet, man.
It's a legitimate point.
Yeah, man. All right, Rob, definitely. Let me let you go, man. That's I got another point, call that's calling in, brother. It's getting crazy.
All right, thanks. See your thing.
Later, Rob.
All right. Trap from YouTube. Go for it.
All right, let me correct you on that. Trav.
Oh, Trav
from YouTube.
Yeah, with a V. Yeah, because I noticed that last time, okay. But, you know, whatever. But, yeah, man, what's going on, y'all?
We're good, man.
Man, we're enjoying all the calls, man. It's a really hot-button topic, like Mario says.
Yeah, man,
this shit, Robert Guerrero, y'all seen my video. I don't know if y'all seen my video.
I've seen it.
My opinion on, you know, Robert Guerrero obviously is not a legitimate contender at 147 pounds. And, you know,
but he was the best 147 pounder.
Alvarez, you know, who, if Floyd fights Canelo Alvarez or not, I think that's not the issue. The issue is Floyd going to clean out 147 pounds? Fight guys like Keith Thurman, fight guys like, you know, Alexander, you know. And it doesn't matter if Alexander, how good he is. That's not the point. The point is, are you 147 pounds or are you a 154-pound fighter when you want to be, and then all of a sudden you want to drop down? I mean, where was Floyd Mayweather when Cotto was hot at 147? Where was Floyd Mayweather when Paul Williams was hot at 147? Or Margarito, for that matter. Besides the bricks and the gloves, nobody knew nothing about that. I mean, that's the issue here. I mean, if he goes up, he's got the skills to beat Canelo. Don't get me wrong. He showed that last night. But it's not really about whether he fights Canelo to me. I think it's just make a decision. Are you going to jump around? You know what I mean? But then make excuses. You can't fight this one and that one, or are you going to clean out? If you clean out, if he was to clean out 147, I would have no problem saying, okay, you can say, Canelo, you got to come down to me. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't a problem. But his track record has shown that, you know, if you're going to pick fights, you know what I'm saying, then you can't complain. I mean, you can't have the excuse and say, you know, well, I'm not fighting Canelo because he's the one bringing the money. So you really don't have no excuse there.
But, you're Trav.
154.
But, Trav, look, I don't get what cleaning out the division means to everyone else. But to me, it means defeating all potentially, you know, viable contenders, guys that have a chance. And I think he did that last night. I don't think there's anyone left in the division. To clean out a division doesn't mean you fight everybody 1 through 10. Keith Thurman and Devin Alexander, I'm sorry, that's not cleaning out the division. That's cleaning out the fucking gutter. At the end of the day, the only person that might be viable enough to test him is Timothy Bradley. And that fight's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. So if that fight's not going to happen, unless Bradley can find some way out of what I hear is a watertight contract, it doesn't matter. You know what I mean? So at this point, we have to find somebody.
It ain't about how good these fighters are. That's not what it's about. It's not about how good Keith Thurman is or how good Devin Alexander is. That shit's irrelevant. What matters is that Floyd Mayweather stays at 154 pounds and is 147. And he's 147 pound fighter, the same way that Andre Ward is 168 fighter. He doesn't jump around. He stays at his weight class. He's proven at that weight class, and if you want to fight him, you got to go there. And then when he moves up, then he moves up to 175. He stays at 175. I mean, jumping around for money. So it ain't about cleaning out the class. Ain't about, you don't know, anything can happen in any fight. You know,
well, of course.
It's our job to pick and choose who we think the best is for Floyd. It's just for him to be consistent. That's
But this is the problem. I completely agree,
Trav,
with you.
I'm gonna hold on, Mario. Trav, I'm gonna let you go. I got another caller on the line, but we got a shitload of callers today. But definitely give us a call back, brother.
All right, Bob.
Give me 15 seconds to finish that point. The hierarchy of boxing exists at a certain point where, I'm sorry, divisions go out the window. Belt holders, all that shit is irrelevant. The belts have declined so much at this point. Floyd Mayweather fights at a level of boxing where, yes, he does have to jump around to find the best viable opponents.
It's me, Mario.
Ashy, you're live on the Boxer Voice, Ashy. Go for it.
What's going on, man? First of all, I want to say what's up to all the people on the panel, but what I want to know is, how is it that we're already criticizing Floyd when at least one or two people from your panel picked his opponent to beat him last night? And now
I did.
That was Mario.
Okay, hold on. Look,
I did.
Ashy, I'm going to explain that, Ashy. Let me explain it, because people keep misunderstanding me, Ashy. I'm not criticizing last night. I think what we saw last night was so incredible that Floyd has completely wiped out the best fighter in the division. I'm not criticizing what he did last night. I'm criticizing what he could potentially be doing for the next 30 months. That's what I'm. That's what. Oh, that's what. Yeah. That's my problem. No, last night was a credible opponent. He beat the brakes off of Guerrero. He completely proved me wrong. Absolutely. No, Ashley, don't get it misunderstood. I am not like one of these other guys who is calling Guerrero cherry pick. Not at all. That was one of the best, if not the best, opponent at 147 for Floyd. And he handled business.
Let me tell you guys something, and because I really didn't know you guys back in the 90s. You know what I'm saying? Only knew you guys in, like, the 2000s. But do you know how long people have been doing that to Floyd Mayweather? They'll pick a guy to beat him and come up with all the excuses as to why they're going to beat him. And when Floyd wipes his ass with him, they immediately go on the fence. Oh, this guy wasn't good enough. That's been going on since like the early, when 2000 came around. That's been going on.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? A lot of people have been criticizing Floyd's selection, and I'm critical too, because to me, he didn't do dick at 140. 140 pounds, that's not his best division at all. Because if you've been around during that time, the top fighters at that weight was Costa Zoo, who was battling all those injuries. That's why you didn't see him on the scene. That's why we had to wait damn near 2 years just to get the Charbonnet Mitchell rematch, because that was to prove who was the best at 140 pounds. It was not Cotto. He was just a prospect.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't Chop Chop, even though he was a WBO champion who zapped Judah before he vacated and went up in weight. The top guys at that weight was Charbonnet Mitchell, Vivian Harris before he got beat, and it was Costa Zoo. Those were the top three guys. Then you had top contenders at that weight. You had Bill Bayless Hurtado, the I think he was either Cuban or Dominican, the guy that Pernell Whitaker beat.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You had a whole bunch of top contenders. You had Zab Judah through the IBF, but he had already got beaten by Costa Zoo. If you criticize Mayweather for not fighting nobody at 140, you got to criticize Cotto for not fighting nobody at 140. Because neither one of those guys fought the top guys at that weight. Point blank period. Ricardo Torres was a no-name fighter, and he only got the acclaim based on how he looked versus Miguel Cotto. But now, let's not even talk about 140. Let's go back to 130. At 130 pounds, Floyd proved he's one of the best 130s to ever come through this game.
And lightweight.
We already know about Chicharito Hernandez. That's a legend. He's Hall of Fame. Point blank, period. That's one of the most smartest fighters they ever campaigned at that weight, period. Period. But here's two names that guys never even bring up. You got Jesus Chavez. He went on to become a two-time world champion after Floyd mopped the floor with his ass. And also arguably beat Eric Morales when they fought. Does anybody remember that fight? Because he was serving up Eric Morales, and then he hurt his rotator cuff and gave him a tough fight for the rest of the fight. Eric Morales won a decision. But look at Eric Morales' face after that fight. And you talking to a guy that fought numerous Eric Morales pay-per-views. I know his whole career since he was at Bantamweight. Fighting on HBO Boxing at the Dark. You know what I'm saying? What about Carlos Hernandez? He went on to become world champion after Floyd mopped the floor with his ass. What about Diego Corrales, the guy everybody thought was going to beat Floyd? Nobody thought Floyd was going to do what he did against that guy. And if you've been around, Vic Corrales was knocking everything out. Brandon Rios' trainer. What's his name? Roberto Garcia?
Robert Garcia.
He was fighting it that way at the same time. He was IBF champ. He was beating the shit out of Diego Corrales. Had the whole fight won. And all of a sudden, it felt right here and changed the game. And he got knocked the fuck out. That's how Diego got on the scene. Then he took out Derek Gaynor. Then he took out Manfredi. So all the hype was behind Corrales. You know what I'm saying? When Mayweather went up the lightweight, the top guy at that weight was not Paul Spadafora, who hadn't fought Dick at that time. It was not Leonard Doran, who hadn't fought Dick. Those guys were protected. The top guy at that weight was arguably Stevie Johnston, because Shane Mosley already left, because Stevie Johnston ducked him point-blank period, and Israel Cardona, if y'all remember him. Those guys ducked Shane Mosley. The only guy that really called out Shane Mosley at 35 was Floyd Mayweather.
Mm-hmm.
But no disrespecting Shane. The Shane sidestepped Floyd. Why? Because why would you fight Floyd for crumbs in a fight that's going to be difficult when you can go fight Oscar for millions, win, lose, or draw?
you was going to get paid. Everybody wants to fight for the money. Oscar was a pay-per-view attraction, not Floyd. But everybody criticized Floyd, said he never wants to fight. That's crap. Because even Zab Judah, when he was just a prospect coming through the game, he was calling out Shane Mosley on ESPN2. You can look it up. This is when he first won a world title. Nobody even really knew who he was. You know what I'm saying? So most of the guys that complain don't have no backstory. They be like Box Rec Warriors. Box Rec only gives you records. They don't give you backstories. You had to have been around. You know what I'm saying? And I've been in this game a long time. And I just sit and listen to all these stories. I'd be like, God damn, who's going to come with some real, real input on the fight game as it stands? Because I'm going to say like this. You ain't going to get it from no media. They've been hating on Floyd ever since he turned down that $2 million contract HBO offered him. Floyd Mayweather called it a slave contract. $2 million? At that time, Floyd should have hopped on it because he didn't have no fan base. But Floyd has always maintained he wasn't being promoted, right? And since he had the most talent, he should be paid the most. And at that time, he made a poor business decision, and the media hopped on his ass. And from that day forward, they never got off of it. Because I've never seen this guy come through the game so hated. What's up?
Yeah, we got to take some more callers. We're basically in drive-by mode. We were trying to end it at 9:30, but we got
to... I'm trying to make it concise as possible.
No, Ashley.
No, man, you make some excellent
you
points.
You made some excellent points, and you said that you can't make these points, or anyone else can't make these points, but you just made them on here. So, hey, this is your platform. This is your platform.
A whole lot more.
This is your platform. This is all. This is our platform is for every boxing fan.
Huh?
Our platform is for every boxing fan.
All right. I appreciate that, man. Go ahead and keep it moving, though. Keep it moving. I mean, I'm sure somebody will say something.
You definitely took a lot of people to school, man.
You did.
So you get the school bell ring.
Appreciate that, man. But there's more. Trust me. The way they criticize Floyd's resume, I can do that to any fighter. Any fighter, you name it, I can criticize him. And don't even say Pacquiao.
Mm-hmm.
You want to talk about Duncan? Go ahead and take the next caller, man. I'll call back later.
All right. We're live with Ernie from the Boxing Lab. Ernie, what's going on, brother? What was your thoughts on last night's fight, man?
Which one? The main event? You mean the sparring session?
Well, the sparring session to you.
For someone who claimed that they were going to bring it, claimed that they were going to see a different side of Floyd we'd never seen before, one that's going to be taken to the depths of hell, we didn't get that, you know, and all the talk that Ghost and his father and his team had said about doing this and that, it was all bark, no bite, and it was disappointing in the aspect that I thought of anybody that was going to be trouble for Floyd as far as being rough and aggressive, it would have been Ghost. Because he kind of, that's his style. You know, we saw what he did to Andre Berto. I was just disappointing. The undercards were great. The Rosado Love was a great fight.
But let me ask you, Ernie.
Yeah.
Before the fight actually happened,
mm-hmm.
you did think that the Ghost was the best possible, available, credible 147-pounder that Floyd could fight at this time, right?
Yeah. I mean, considering that there's really nothing out there, the division pretty much is devoid of true marketability and talent. You know, Andre Berto would have been okay, but he would have been along the same lines as Ghost. You know, it's one of those things where Floyd kind of prevails over boxing, but he's also prevailing over a rather weak division.
And what's your thoughts on fight fans clamoring, demanding, and wanting to force Mayweather to move up to 154 and face Canelo Alvarez now rather than later? Basically because they just want to see him lose.
Yeah, they want to see – it's at a point now where they want to see him stretch a ceiling that, to me, I think 54 was, you know, he moved up to 54 to take on certain people. Let's not hide this. I mean, he's not going up there to say I'm the best at 154 pounds. No, he went up there selectively to face two guys, two big name guys. One was Oscar, and two was Cotto. And that literally is the only reason why he would do that. Is Canelo big enough? He's getting there. But considering this kid is young, considering this kid's improving fight by fight, I mean, we saw, you know, a masterful performance against Austin Trout where he was the better boxer, amazingly enough. I don't see him wanting to do that. I maybe at best a catch weight. You know, maybe we get him, you know, maybe he boils Canelo down to 50 or something. Other than that, I don't really think they're in any hurry to face Canelo.
Well, Arnie, but do you think that it's okay? Well, hold on. So you're saying that Floyd doesn't want to fight, or are you saying that you also agree in that they shouldn't fight, that he's too big?
I think he's too big. Canelo's never weighed 147 pounds. It's been years since he's weighed that little. I remember when they were trying to get him to go to 47. I think the lowest he ever got was 49. You know, and so that speaks volumes. And he was a kid then, and he's starting to mature now. He's a big frame. You know, I don't think Floyd. I think Floyd has an interest. I'm gonna put it out there. I don't think Floyd is afraid of fighting anybody. I mean, the guy's fought 44 times. I really don't see the notion that he's afraid to fight anybody. But I do think in Canelo Alvarez, he sees a young, hungry kid looking for stardom and in a division that I think is really probably too high for him, for Floyd. Floyd's a small guy. He's not that big. I mean, you know, he's grown into his welterweight body, you know, rather well. But I think stretching it another 7 pounds for a young, you know, a young guy would be a stretch. I mean, now for guys like Oscar, who is fighting once a year, and Cotto, who's at the tail end of his career, I think it's a safe. Those were both safer bets, but I think this one, I think it's a risk, and I don't think it's a risk Floyd is not necessarily willing to take. I think there's, you know, I think he can sit there, and now that he's got his deal from Showtime in place, I think he can force their hand and make them look for other options.
But don't you think
Hold on, Mario. What's your thoughts on Floyd Mayweather Sr. yesterday giving an interview to iLondon saying that one of Floyd's possible five fights left is going to be with Paul Spadafora?
Oh, Lord. I don't know how that guy gets his name out there repeatedly. Spatty's not fought anybody in some time. I mean, yeah, he fights, you know, back east on small Pennsylvania cards. But why in the world does his name ever get brought up as anything other than just curiosity? It's beyond me. And Senior, you know what, it actually kind of goes to what Steve Kim was saying way, way back, I would say almost a year ago, and saying that Spadafora was being thought of as an opponent for Mayweather. You know, I think it's ridiculous. I think it would really be stretching the limits of what we would pay for as far as a Floyd Mayweather fight, and that's ridiculous.
Yeah, man. I think other than the fact that he's Italian and he's got the whole Rocky Marciano undefeated record going on, that's all they could sell. But yeah. I don't see how you would get into a Spadafora fight when the money is just much greater with a Canelo fight. But
yeah.
Vic, you got anything for Ernie before we let him go?
Yeah, absolutely. AE, man, I just want to know, not from you or from anyone else, but when we look at Mayweather and we look at his next fight and people are saying Canelo's not credible because, oh, he just beat Austin Trout. But a month ago, we didn't think he could beat Austin Trout.
Yeah.
And now they're saying Canelo's too big. But as Money Mayweather, as his nickname is Money, right? His nickname is Money. Is there any bigger fight for Floyd Mayweather than Canelo Alvarez?
No, none. I don't think so. I think we could throw a Pacquiao fight out the window. It'll never happen. It won't happen. Sergio Martinez was the idea of Sergio Martinez was floated around about 18 months ago. I think that's thrown out the window. I think he'd have trouble getting close to 54 let alone below 54. So you got to kind of hope that someone comes up from 40, you know, with a big enough name. I mean, you know, if Golden Boy has their proposed tournament where, you know, the winner of Garcia Judah, which is now Danny Garcia, faces the winner of Matisse versus Peterson, and throw Khan into that mix, well, if you get the actual true winner of that kind of round-robin tournament thing going on, maybe they have a shot at facing Floyd in some type of viable matchup. But even then, that's a stretch. The air is very thin where Floyd belongs. And for someone to kind of reach that status, you know, it seems nowadays that you only have to get on a 2 or 3 fight streak where you're on TV to get that fight. I mean, you saw Ortiz beat Berto, so he got it. You saw Ghost beat Berto. Poor Berto. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to have a career of being, you know, stellar or at an elite level. It seems like you reel off a couple wins here and there, you're in the sweepstakes. And I wouldn't be surprised to see the name Devin Alexander thrown out there. You know, I wouldn't be surprised to see Chino Maidana thrown out there. You know, there's going to be names out there, I think, you know, just trying to be thrown out there, Ernie, for the sake of satisfying. Yes.
But, I mean, after watching what he did yesterday and realizing that he hasn't lost a step, realizing that he's so much faster than other opponents, should we even allow a Devin Alexander or a Chino Maidana? Should we, like most fight fans that called in today, be lighting the torches and stand in front of his house with pitchforks and Canelo signs?
Yeah, but you know what? At some point, I mean, what makes – okay, here's my question. I mean, as far as the matchup is concerned, there's none bigger out there. But as far as fightability, does Canelo bring anything different that anybody else did it? I mean, you know, to me, I'm not sure that he's much more skilled than any of the guys we're going to throw up out there. I mean, if you sat there and said, you know, who's more skilled, Devin Alexander or Canelo Alvarez, a lot of people would be a decent debate. You know, as far as skills are concerned, as far as posing the challenge actually in the ring for Floyd, he's in a rare company. There's very few people there's no one around him in his division that I think can pose a true threat. You have to go into, you know, the mythical pound for pound list to see if someone matches up. I mean, can you imagine if Andre Ward was close to his division? That would be something. You know, a Sergio Martinez, you know, maybe 18 months ago would have been fun. You know, but now you're starting to stretch. You're starting to stretch and wonder. You know, one name I would love to see, but I don't think it'll happen simply because he's still now kind of associated with Top Rank. I wouldn't mind seeing a rematch with Marquez. Marquez at 47 now seems a little bit more filled out. He seems to be more accustomed to being at 47. You know, and he's still probably skill-wise, is probably up there with some of the best at 47 right now.
But okay, let me ask you, Ernie. Floyd came out and made this whole spectacle about, you know, he's only got 6 fights, now 5 fights left, 30 months, Showtime deal, then he's retired, you know, whatever. So at the end of the day, shouldn't he be gearing towards something? Like, if you're in the sport as a prospect or a contender, you're working towards a title. When you get to that level of Floyd, you're working towards, you know, you're gearing up for something spectacular. And if there's nothing in line, I mean, wouldn't you say that there's a pretty good assumption that whatever the pay-per-view numbers come in from last night, they're going to drop significantly with any proposed actual fight that could be made from here on out?
We're in a world where, I mean, as far as, honestly, I think Golden Boy, I think Top Rank, I think HBO, and I think Showtime, I think they're kind of maybe secretly worried. You know, maybe not. I mean, on the surface, they probably won't say, oh, yeah, we're worried. But I think behind the scenes, they know that Floyd may or may not fight 5 more times. I mean, I think that's just the maximum that, I mean, if you actually read the press release, it's the maximum. So he may not fight 5 more times. Manny's at the end of his career. He's been a pay-per-view draw. beat great, good B-sides like Marquez, Martinez. They're kind of falling by the wayside. So I think secretly the mega matchup is starting to worry the big promoters and the big networks because there isn't much left. I mean, if we're sitting here having a whole debate on your wonderful show, you know, by the way, it's a fantastic show, you guys.
Thank you.
If we're thank worrying you. About what we can throw out in front of Floyd, that screams bigger problems than just matchups for Floyd. Who's going to bring us into that next generation? Who's going to pull the numbers that we want that we've gotten accustomed to?
Great point. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I just don't believe that after Floyd and after Pacquiao, we're going to be in those times when people sold 1 point whatever.
Yeah.
I think we're going to go back down to the 250s and 500s where that was good. Same thing like music. When a musician could put out an album and go gold and he was glorified. Ever since people start going diamond like Eminem and fucking Rihanna, you know, now if you don't go platinum, you ain't shit.
Yeah. That's a good point. I mean, everything has its cycle. I think boxing, you know, I think everybody involved as far as, you know, they got to start getting creative with it, you know. Unless you want to force Abner Morris to gain 20 pounds so he could become an opponent for Floyd.
or I'll Leo pitch this for one to you.
25 pounds for Leo.
One of our callers pitched this at us, and they said, well, Danny Garcia's the Ring Magazine champ. Floyd's the Ring Magazine champ. That's an easier weight for Floyd to either get down to or Danny to get up to.
Mm-hmm.
But, again, after watching him beat the shit out of Guerrero, I don't think Danny presents any danger at all.
You know, Danny, I think Danny's at a point almost, you know, where – you know, he's either I think when you see guys young like him, like Canelo too, you start seeing good things about him, but you also start seeing some of the flaws. I mean, we saw that with Brandon, you know, Brandon Rios. You know, you saw some of the great things that he does. He's all action, he's got a stellar chin, and he can crack with the other hand. But as time progressed and as enamored as we are with Bam Bam Brandon Rios, we started seeing chinks in the armor. You know, he can get caught with the right hand pretty easily. he's slow-footed. You know, and you start saying, okay, well, you know what? Maybe he's not the guy we make him out to be. And I think the same will happen with Danny. I mean, Danny, you know, can crack with both hands, but he gets hit an awful lot. He does remind me a lot of Brandon in that he's got dynamite for hands, but he gets hit a lot. And if you can box him and keep him out at a distance, that's beneficial to you. He can't fight on the inside. That's one thing that I say Brandon Rios has that Danny doesn't. Danny can't fight inside at all. I mean, he sucks on the inside. He'd rather keep it at his distance. I think we're going to start seeing that, you know. And so I think with Garcia, it's going to be a tough sell simply because he is still kind of a crude kid.
Well, E, man, thanks for calling in. I don't know
if Vic is
trying to cut you off. You got anything else for him?
No, and my only thing is who should Floyd fight next if not Canelo? That's all I want to know. I mean, exactly.
Great question. Actually, I wouldn't be surprised to see, you know, if Lamont gets past Lucas on the 18th, you know, I wouldn't be surprised. I you know, there is a reason why Al Haymon signed Lucas Matisse. I think he's kind of, you know, making his presence known. I think more than just hedging his bets and having guys, you know, like, you know, Garcia and now Lucas in his pockets, I think he's trying to find possible opponents for Floyd, you know. And I think that's kind of, you know, maybe a kind of a out there thought about that. But I think maybe he signed Lucas Matisse because, you know, should he beat Lamont? Should he go around and perhaps beat Danny Garcia or, you know, Al kind of keep them away from each other? He now becomes an opponent for Floyd Mayweather, surprisingly enough. You know, and, you know, I would say Lamont, or the Lamont Lucas winner gets their name thrown into the speech. I really do. I know it's not ridiculous, but I also called that Victor Ortiz last year was going to be an opponent for Mayweather, and everybody laughed until he actually was an opponent for Floyd. I wouldn't be surprised to see the winner
for Matisse
and Matisse. Yes.
Funny thing you say is about Matisse, right? So now that Al Haymon signed him, and we rarely, if not only one time, see two Al Haymon fighters in the ring together, which were Peter Quillen and Robert Guerrero. If Matisse advances in the Peterson fight, is he automatically a Mayweather opponent and Haymon basically protects Danny Garcia?
No, I think...
Because I'm pretty sure if he says, hey, why would you fight Garcia when we're going to give you 2.5 or 2 million to fight Mayweather?
Yeah, see, and that's another option you have to think about with Floyd. Floyd's opponent, you know, they think they cash in, but you're not getting comparable money. You know, you're not going to get, you know, a 70-30 split. It's more going to be like 90-10. I mean, that's what these guys... Floyd got $32 million guaranteed. Robert got $3 million. I mean, that's roughly 10% of what Floyd got. You know, Lucas would come in on the cheap. You know, I would say $3 million would satisfy him, you know, versus, you know, facing Danny Garcia for, I don't know, $1.5 million, maybe $1 million. Yeah, I mean, that's a great viewpoint. I think that actually favors, you know, a Lucas fight. You know, a Peterson fight, I think, is out there too. You know, I don't think a Garcia fight's out there yet. You know, I think, you know, he's starting to come into his own. He's starting to sell well in Brooklyn. And once he starts getting that name going, you know, I think they're going to keep trotting out opponents for Floyd until a Garcia comes up, you know, starts building the name for himself. Until, you know, a Canelo fight is something that we no longer can avoid.
That's a great point.
The Canelo fight happens towards the end of this run for Floyd.
Yeah, that's a great point because
I said after the fifth fight.
I said
the fifth fight with the sixth fight as the rematch option. But go ahead, Mario. I'm sorry.
No, and really, it's a great point, and it really doesn't even have to happen. If let's say Matisse starches everyone in this, you know, proposed tournament or whatever. I mean, he starts looking like a really viable contender, and he's not a small junior welterweight. You know what I mean? Like he's a guy who could, I think, carry his size at least somewhat, and he packs a big enough punch at 140 that you have to think that he's at least going to be somewhat of a dangerous puncher at 147. So I think that's a fight that at least makes sense, but I think you're absolutely right. I think Peterson and guys like Garcia, the more they win, the more viable they become. And we could be changing our tone. I mean, that's a great point. I think that's really the first person that's kind of made that point. Like, the proposed Danny fight was more immediately. And I feel like if, you know, Floyd kills himself to make a catch weight, well, then maybe that evens up the playing field a little bit. But you're right. I mean, we could be talking a year from now, and we could have three potential opponents that we're all clamoring to see. We could say, oh, I want to see Matisse. No, I want to see Peterson. Oh, I want to see, Garcia. And so, you know, I guess all hope isn't lost. But I guess for me, it's just if Floyd were to walk away from the sport right now and say, I'm not going to fight Canelo, get over it, I'm going to retire, I would be okay with it. There's no other fight I really care to see. You know what I mean? Yeah. And so that's where I'm at right now with all these fights and the way everything turned out last night and the way I think other fights would. Because you're right. As bad as the Guerrero fight was, I think some of the other proposed matchups would be worse, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I mean, we almost got Devin Alexander. I mean, would you guys have bought a Mayweather-Alexander fight?
I would buy anything, but, you know.
I would buy anything, too.
But I get your point.
Shit as chocolate cake, and I'm buying it. So,
but I get the point Ernie's trying to make. I mean, you know, we are the disgusting degenerates that buy that stuff, no matter what it is. But there are people out there that, you know what I mean. It really can vary. And when we get these pay-per-view numbers, we're gonna find out exactly how far some of this stuff went. You know what I mean? We're gonna see how deep that promotional power went. I don't think they're going to be that bad. I really don't think they're going to be as bad as some people think. I think they will crack a mil. Karen Mulvaney, what did he say, Ness? He said it has to get to 1.2. Did he say 1.15, something like that?
Break even?
That's what he said. I think that they had said. But, you know, I don't think it's ludicrous to assume that they get to those numbers. I really don't.
It'll be tough.
I hope that they do, because I don't want to see anybody hating on Floyd more than they already are.
Well, I mean, I don't think that hate can be. I think the hate is what it is. I don't think it's ever going to go away. But as long as they appreciate what they see in there, as long as they understand what we're seeing is very rare, then that's cool with me. I don't care. Let them hate. I mean, I've had the pleasure of watching and being a fan of Floyd for some time. You know, I mean, I'm not one of those guys that goes out there and says he's not interesting. I enjoy what he does in the ring. I think it's masterful when he, after three rounds, he literally has you figured out. I mean, I was sitting here, Steve Kim was here, one of the matchmakers for Golden Boy was here, a bunch of my friends were here, and by the third round, we all knew. Floyd had him figured out. It's done. It's over. Watch. Lead right hand. Blah. Jab. Blah. And it's masterful to me to see that. Granted, he's an overwhelming underdog, but who isn't going to be an overwhelming underdog with Floyd? I mean, even if you throw Canelo in there, I mean, it's point smaller than a 7-1 underdog, but he's still going to be a 3-1 underdog.
At least,
no matter what, he's always going to be the bigger risk, or he's always going to be that much more talented than whoever he steps into. So at this point, it's up to Golden Boy and Al Heyman to really push B-side for Floyd, so he can make this contract work and viable.
Yeah, well, E, we're not going to take any more of your time. Thanks for calling in, man.
Oh, my pleasure, guys. Pleasure.
Man, one day we got to get all three of you guys here live on camera with us.
Oh, man, we'd love that.
Hey, one day we're going to do a joint show, the two best fucking shows on the planet together.
Yeah, we'd love that. I mean, we you know, like I said, we support you guys 100%. You guys have a wonderful show. Vic is my dude, man. I've traveled the ends of the earth with that kid. I met Ness over at the Coto Trout. Great kicking it with him. And Mario, hopefully one day I get to meet you too, man. But you guys are fantastic. Keep doing what you're doing. You know, just keep shining, man, because you're putting a good light on boxing.
Thanks, man. Appreciate that.
Thank you very much, man, Ernie. You have a good night.
You too, guys. Take care.
You too. Good night.
All right. Yeah, man, I'm going to have to get a whole nother radio show in here to help Vic and Mario, because guess what? I'm in the lead, baby.
Oh, man.
What did he say? Look, you're what?
He said he's in the lead, Vic.
I'm in the lead.
What?
I want to see. Wait, hold up, because you picked Acosta. What did your final record wind up being?
And you picked
Gonzalez.
But that one fight.
And you also picked Diego Magdaleno to beat Rocky Martinez, if I'm not mistaken.
Nah.
And you also picked Salido to beat Marky Garcia.
That was you.
My God. You see how he's backtracking, Mario? Oh, my God. This dude said Diego was going to beat Rocky Martinez. Come on.
Hey, we got it on camera.
Huh?
Didn't you pick Diego, too?
Hell no, I picked Rocky. I'm Puerto Rican.
All right, we got to tally it up. We're going to tally it up before Thursday's show.
I will. I will. And I will fund that show where you said Salido was going to beat Mikey Garcia off pad work.
No, he did.
Look, that's fine. I admitted that one a long time ago, but what's that? You got three losses for me. How many you got? Let's be real.
Also, Rosado Golovkin.
You picked Rosado Golovkin?
Okay.
We can go back. We're probably even right now. Hey, that's fine.
Yeah, I think it's even.
I got to have you at least by one.
No, you can't have me by one. You can't have me by one when you pick shit undercards. I mean, you're good at main events, but you can't call it undercard for your life.
All right. Worst case scenario, Vic. Worst case scenario, I'm not in the lead, and me and you are at a tie, but Mario.
Yeah, man. That's true.
We gotta break this up into half.
True.
Like we gotta reset. We gotta reset the numbers after June.
What's wrong with you? I should point you.
We gotta reset the numbers after June, because this.
I think Mario picked
I think Mario picked Bradley and Pacquiao. I don't know.
All right, so we're gonna run through this schedule. ESPN2 Friday night fights, May 10th. We got Vernon Paris versus Manuel Perez. We got my boy. Make sure you tune in to Joel Diaz Jr., the future, the truth. Again, stepping it up with 11 fights. Gary Russell, take fucking notes. And then on Unimas, a fight that Mario will be live in. Vic Darchinian returns under his new promotional banner, Top Rank Boxing versus Javier Gallo. Gallo stands for chicken. You already know what's going to happen there.
He's dying.
So basically, that's it, fellas. Thanks, everyone for calling in. Hold on. Matter of fact, I want to give one guy a call back, man. He called so much, and he didn't even get through. Let's give him a call, 404. I hope he makes it quick because I got to eat. He was calling all show, but he just bad timing. Come on, 404.
You lose.
We'll call him early next show.
What was that?
I got one other guy that's been trying all day. It's the last one we're trying to call back.
Yo, did Boogie Down Sean and Dream and all these faggots call in?
Nah, they didn't call.
They didn't call in?
Sean called?
Sean did.
Oh, I was, all right. It must have been early.
All
right, so we didn't get him. Well,
thanks. I hope it wasn't one of them 13-year-olds.
And as always,
remember to rate us 5 stars on iTunes.
Is that Liam?
Sure. Check out theboxingvoice.com for some of the best articles.
And that's Savannah from Germany.
Boxing.
And you could always catch us.
Join us every Thursday and Sunday live at 7 p.m. Eastern Time.
Oh, damn, we just had a caller, but he hung up. I'm going to give him a call back since we're just sitting here. Last caller of the night. I don't think he got through either. This 254, he's been trying for a minute. It was crazy today, dude. Like,
it was good.
Never.
You tell me it was good.
We didn't never get to speak to you, did we?
Yeah, no, I called in earlier. I just wanted to chime in.
Okay.
But whether I chime in, that one caller, he asked the question, man, when he brought down all Mayweather fights. So I don't got too much to say. Pretty much earlier, Mario and Vic, you guys just seen I had a lot of disdain for Mayweather, the way y'all speaking. Bottom line. I understand you think he cherry picks or whatever the case, but I think Canelo should fight some more fighters. He needs to fight whoever the best is at 47 or move up. Personally, I think he's going to fight Amir Khan next because I think it's a big fight, probably bigger than Hatton.
No, it won't be bigger than Hatton. But
no, look, so let me ask you a question.
I think it will.
You think Mayweather Khan is bigger than Mayweather Canelo at this point? And you're saying Canelo has to prove himself.
I think we need to be patient and let him fight. I think he's going to fight Canelo, but I don't think he's going to fight him next. Why is he going to fight him next? I think he's going to fight him last.
He doesn't have much time to be patient, man. He's only got 5 fights left in his career. You know, by that time, Canelo could be a blown-up fucking 160 fighter.
Canelo could be a middleweight.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. And look, at the end of the day, pick another fighter other than Canelo that has a better chance of beating Floyd. I'm not saying Canelo beats Floyd. Not at all.
I don't either.
Not at all. But what I'm saying is name a better fighter than Canelo that makes it a closer fight on paper going into it. You know what I'm saying? Like, everyone else is like 90-10. Canelo at the very least, is 85-15 at the very least. You know what I'm saying? And the height advantage is his only advantage. He's not a better boxer. Size advantage.
Floyd's a taller fighter.
No, I meant size advantage.
Floyd's a taller fighter.
Besides the strength factor.
Hey, guys.
Hey, that's not this thing I'm talking about, man. You guys are pretty new to most of the time, but I see.
No. Hey.
Mario, you just seem to be, you know, you're changing up. Go on, man. Earlier you were sweating. When Vic came on the show, you got real ballsy. Before that, everybody was getting on you. You wasn't saying nothing. That's the truth. So, Vic, you must be his guy. When you get on, and he got balls.
Nah, man. No, I'm telling you.
My bad, man. I just think Canelo's a more worthy opponent than Khan. I mean, Khan almost got killed by Julio Diaz. Julio Diaz almost took this nigga out. Khan was about to go to sleep on a 135-pounder.
He's going to fight Canelo next.
If Mayweather, I don't know why you guys are not saying this.
If he fights Canelo next fight and he beats the shit out of him like he did Guerrero, what would you say then? Come on, man.
I wouldn't say nothing.
Mario, if he beats Canelo and he beats the shit out of him, what are you going to say?
Nothing.
He should retire. He should He should retire. No, that, I'm telling you. Look, and it's not even. That's what I'm saying. Look, no, but that's what I'm saying is you're missing the point. No. You're missing the point. You think that I want to see Canelo fight Mayweather? No. Look, you think I want to see Canelo fight Mayweather because I think Canelo will win, and that's where you're wrong, and that's where everyone's wrong. I'm not saying I want to see that fight because I think he'll win. I want to see that fight.
No, he's
the most pageant type of fight.
He's Canelo.
I want to see Canelo Mayweather because it's the biggest fight in the history of the sport. That's what I'm saying. Mayweather.
I said I don't want to see Mayweather.
They're misunderstanding you, Mario.
They're misunderstanding me completely. I don't want to see Mayweather Canelo because I think Canelo wins. I think Mayweather could beat Canelo. I really do. In fact, I think he beats him quite easily. But I want to see Canelo Mayweather because they're the two biggest cash cows in boxing. It would be the most extravagant fight ever. That's what I live for, guys. I'm a boxing fan.
Okay,
I want to see the Super Bowl of boxing. He can retire for all I I don't give a shit. He can retire. He can retire. I don't care. He can retire.
I'm at Canelo.
No, see, that's what I'm saying.
All right,
y'all think
we gotta
that I'm trying
let you
to...
go, man. We gotta let you go. It's 10 o'clock. We did 3 hours, man.
Thanks for calling, man.
Yeah, get some.
It was a good call.
Hey, what you guys didn't tell that caller, and what you guys haven't said is, Mayweather fights Khan, he's going to put that boy to sleep. And the only thing I'll be saying is,
I bet you sleep with the night light.
That's the best.
Go check out my boy Krispy Kreme, baby.
I don't know. I think Khan. Show, man. I think Khan's got some upside.
You're the only one that does, but that's all right. That's okay.
I don't even want to start that. We'll go for another hour.
I don't want to start that right now.
No. I said I think Khan has some upside in the Mayweather fight. No, I know. I don't even want to start right now. We're going to go for another hour.
No, this is for you.
Good boy. Good boy. Good boy.
He's out of control tonight.
All I want to see is I want to see Jay Leon Love fight Golovkin.
I don't think Jay Leon's mom want to see him fight.
I'm sorry, I know I was late, but
that was the rim shot.
But I thought Rosado won. I don't care what anyone says.
Yeah, I did too. I had him 96-93. But I am your host, Ness GTO. Follow me on Twitter. To my left is if you're looking at me, to my right is Mario Munguia at Mario Munguia. And to my left would be Boxing Voice _ Vic. We are the Boxing Voice. You guys are the voice of the people. And thank you for calling in tonight. We'll be back